Hey everybody, before we get started, just want to let you know that we are accepting submissions for the narrative portion of our podcast. In fact, we will always be accepting submissions. This podcast was made as a way to get people's stories out there. If you have an original short story and want to get it out there at full credit, send it to storytellercast@gmail.com. Once again, that is storytellercast@gmail.com. Cast with an S at the end. 1 cent, one of us will read it, or if you hate our voices and think you can do better, which honestly you probably could, send in your own voice recording of the story. For details, email us at storytellercasts@gmail.com. Once again, that's storytellercasts@gmail.com. So, like, that skeleton usually costs, like, $40, $50. Oh, wow. Bucks. Yeah, and you buy it, like, a fucking Ralph's. But it's fully posable. That's the deal.
Oh, okay.
And it stays pretty well. And we've always wanted one, but we were like, we're not going to pay $40 or $50 for that.
Have you always wanted one just for the pun of literally leaving it in the back of a closet?
Yeah.
It's a good use of money.
So once Halloween ended, we do our annual Halloween shopping. Yeah, see that you started noticing it. Yeah, the chair creak I started noticing once I started recording videos in here. And like that's when I would start using wooden chairs and I would bring them in, even if it wasn't that comfortable. Anyway, we did our annual Halloween shopping, you know, where you buy candy after Halloween.
Sure.
Because it's like $2 you get and big ass pack of like Reese's pumpkins, or
everyone wants to get rid of their garbage Halloween candy.
Yeah.
Immediately.
Oh, so it's the best. I love after Halloween like candy shopping, and that was on sale for like $15.
No.
So Nick bought it, and now we have it. We even dressed it up at one point and like left it at a table.
I love it. I think it really pulls the room together.
I think so too. Nick calls it Bernie, and like. It's great.
I'm so glad that you, me, and Bernie can have this conversation together.
It's like Nick's not even missing.
It really is.
It's like his skeleton just popped out and left it here.
I mean, it's still Nick's skeleton. So yeah. This is Nick's skeleton with
here.
Us.
Yeah, he's here with us.
Yeah.
Or his skeleton is.
His skeleton is.
I mean, it finally got out. Like, I think Nick yawned big enough that his skeleton was able to jump out.
And his skeleton's been meaning to do a lot of projects that Nick's just not on board with.
They're both great. They're both great. They're
both great guys.
Creators in their own right, but just different ideas.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Two very different mantras.
Very, very different, like, mindsets creatively. Yeah.
One's very Machiavelli-ish, and the other one believes in a new world order.
Sure.
So.
Which one's which? Well, we'll have to have that conversation later.
We'll explore this as the podcast goes out, goes throughout. Okay, welcome to the third episode of Storyteller Cast Life. Sadly, Nick couldn't be here just due to scheduling conflicts and stuff. He's got classes. We don't have classes at this time.
At least not now.
Yeah. So that's just how it tend to work out. Hopefully this episode proves that we don't need him and we could do this entire project without him.
I can't wait for him to listen to this.
Oh, I can't wait either. I don't think he will. Just because
he only listens to his own voice.
He'll want me to give him like the condensed version. So what's going to happen is I'll probably have to like even cut a bunch of stuff for him that only he will have. He's an asshole like that. So what have you been up to, Ian? Yeah.
Well, on the work front, I've been, just doing regular, like, college stuff. The semester's ending, doing that
sure.
kind of thing.
Yeah.
But, other than that, I've been dabbling in a lot of, really specific fiction genres.
Okay.
At least I've been going for, Native American legends and, like, Caribbean mythology.
Okay, yeah, there's a lot going
for
both of those.
There's a lot happening there.
Which one's the Caribbean one where you have that thing that's on your back and like it just whispers stuff? There's a JoJo stand based off of it named Cheap Trick. So I know that's like a legend in the Caribbean, and different islands have different names for it or something.
Yeah, they have different versions of it's like a giant beetle, I think, is what it was in the original story.
Okay.
And it hooks onto your back and it just says messed up things to you.
See, I know there's one island that views it as a bird type deal. And I don't remember what the island specifically is. But...
I mean, it could be any of the... it's basically any of them but the ones that England are in. Any of them. Okay, yeah.
I mean the ones that weren't fixed. Is
that well, they live in proper houses with
see, being Hispanic, Ian, I think the conquistador is coming over and making us all well-mannered and right.
By, really helped. They just showed up and they were like, well, none of these books are right.
Yes.
So set, no. We have to set all of these
stop
on fire.
Stop making that calendar. Stop it.
Who needs time that accurate?
Yeah. Yeah, who needs time like a couple hundred years ahead?
who will ever use that?
Yeah, come on.
You don't think people are going to be worried about that when we stop, I mean, exactly 2,000 years in the future? Nah. They're going to be fine.
Who's gonna like, oh man, I remember being, in school, like, that was going around and people were buying into it.
Yeah.
So if that movie had just come out, 2012, which, if that movie's anything, it's kind of just fun to watch all the money go into the effects.
That's a whole lot of money you're looking at.
Yeah, it's...
I would have also... I think equally entertaining would have been watching John Cusack light cigars with $100 bills.
Yeah.
I think that would have been...
Oh, I'd watch that. I don't need a plot. I could just... You just watch that. But yeah, I remember when that was going around.
I was just in a bookstore the other day in Cerritos, and it's a used bookstore, and I actually happened upon a copy of this book called What to Expect in Y2K.
Okay.
And it was published in 98, 99.
Sure.
And, like, the back cover, like, verbatim, what it said was something along the lines of, like, we all know the world is going to end in 2012. At the stroke of midnight in December 31st, we're just going to see all the nuclear arms self-detonate. That's clearly what's going to happen. And, you know, as someone who lived through that, and I remember when everyone died, that was a really hard time for me.
It was really tough. That's why Nick Skeleton was, like, able to jump out of his body. So
we're all irradiated mutants.
Yeah.
So you know, but, you know, there's it's not all bad. You know, we have that guitar player with a flamethrower on it. It's, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Man, we call him Dufourier. It's fucking dope.
It's,
We have, like, Mustangs with tank wheels.
We have a rank called what was it?
War Boys.
War Boys. Yeah. I mean, it's all. It's
I
all
saw great. That movie four times in theaters. So.
It's but, like Imperiosa is also
Furiosa.
Furiosa, but there's a rank that she has.
Yeah. It's something along the lines it's of like Imperial or whatever.
Imperial something.
Yeah.
I do enjoy that.
That fucking movie is so goddamn good, Ian. So like. Fuck, and I was just talking about someone, like, marking out about it. Oh, I want to get back to Native American Caribbean stuff.
Oh, for sure.
But hang on, have you watched the anime Flip Flappers?
I've not seen the anime Flip Flappers.
Since we're talking about Mad Max, can I highly suggest you watch Flip Flappers?
Please highly suggest.
Okay, I don't want to say any more
than
that.
Okay.
Other than there is something Mad Max related.
Oh, okay.
And it's awesome. Okay. So go check it out. You would probably dig it. It's a very Gynex-y kind of show.
Oh, I do like their stuff.
Yeah, a lot of, like, kind of old, whimsical. Very whimsical.
Whimsical as shit, you guys.
Yeah.
So fucking whimsical.
Plus, some of the guys on Space Sandy are working on it.
Oh, cool.
Which is totally, like, you can totally see it with some of the way the shots are done.
Mm-hmm.
And plus, one of the characters has a goddamn flying surfboard, so.
That does sound fun.
It does sound fun. My god. There's so many shots in there that just, I can point out from, like, other Gynex shows. You have the classic, you have the Fooly Cooly stop at a train scene.
Oh, uh-huh.
And, oh my god, there's so many Gynex trains. Like, just train rides where they're sitting and, like, staring out a window and saying stuff, or like just in the middle, and there's no one else there except one person, and it's very cool. But again, it is very whimsical, so they don't like expect anything too crazy.
Okay.
I'm kind of just seeing where it goes from here, because they have dropped a few things.
Is it in the middle of run right now?
Yeah, I think it's episode 8. Okay. I don't know how many episodes they're going for. I want to say it's 12.
Okay.
I can double check. Someone could check for me. But yeah, so going back to Caribbean and
Native American myths.
So anything that jumps out at you?
Let's see. What did jump out at me? I mean, just some of the legends that are really interesting to me were... I've been really into Sioux. I've been reading a biography about an actual person who existed called Black Elk. And he was like a second cousin to Crazy Horse. And he fought at Little Bighorn and all that kind of stuff.
That's cool.
But like he had like these really intense visions, like Dream Quest kind of shit, where he like was a tree and then he saw the entirety of the earth and then six old men and a woman who was a deer spoke to him. It's really, I really dig that kind of stuff. The connection to nature and giving it like this very specific character.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
That was always interesting to me. But in the Caribbean, in like Haiti and Puerto Rico, there's a legend about the Black Hat Man, which is one of my favorite stories because it has no moral at all. And I think that's one of my favorite. Because like a lot of those stories...
Because a lot of myths have to have a moral. Or that's why a lot of them were made.
You're supposed to have a takeaway, children.
Yeah.
Don't suck
your thumbs. Otherwise, they'll be cut off. Yeah.
Don't go in the water or else turtle gremlins will drown you.
Don't lose your baby because then a lady by a river will call you or something.
That's right.
I'm sure I got that right.
That's almost exactly. But the Black Hat Man is essentially just like a ghost kind of guy who rides on a black horse, and he's just very attractive, and then he's going to have sex with your wife. And then he goes away. And that's all that happens.
Awesome.
He's just a ghost, and he shows up, and he does...
Oh, that's just so people can cheat.
It was a man in the black hat.
There was nothing I could have done.
Hands are tied. I don't know what you want me to do.
That's why I like Roman mythology and Greek mythology so much. Mm-hmm. I think it's because a lot of it's just written so they can get away with shit.
Oh yeah.
Like orgies and everything without feeling too bad.
I mean, if he did it,
yeah.
What do you got? Don't be worried about it.
Come on. If anything, I'm kind of godlike in that
sense. The Romans are... This is a slight sidetrack from mythology, but like, there's this great book by Pliny the Elder about like home remedies. It's a book of medicine.
Sure.
But it's written in a time when that's not a thing. And so like there's just three things I have to mention.
Okay.
Because they're just insane. One is, he then gives a list of when you have relieved yourself.
Okay.
Down to number two. When you take a dump.
Okay.
When you shit, you should... he then takes a list of things that he recommends you use. And the top of the list is swan's neck.
To wipe your ass with
a swan's neck. Which, he doesn't specify is it a dead swan? Or is it a still living swan?
Yeah.
I need more information. Also,
you do it like a towel, you know, where
you
put it between
floss.
Your legs. Yeah.
The other thing he talked about was if you have like a bladder infection.
Okay.
The way to fix it is to eat pig's tail raw.
Okay.
And then urinate in your dog's or your neighbor's dog's bed.
Okay.
Sure. That's how medicine works.
And I tell you, like, I don't do anything after I just...
Nope, that's it. You eat the pig, and then you have to piss in a dog's bed. That's how it fixes that.
Yeah.
That's fun. Medicine. That's science. We've done the science, guys.
I don't know.
My third one that's my favorite is technically actually something that does work.
Okay.
Though it's not... It's, you, have a cup made of antimony, which is a type of pure element. It's an elemental metal. and you pour wine in it and you let it set overnight, and then you drink the antimony, and antimony is poison.
Yeah.
So it irritates the entire inside of your digestive, and it's supposed to be good for constipation.
Sure. I mean, it works.
It works. I mean, you won't be anymore.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Also,
it gets rid of the thing.
You kind of poison yourself a little bit. And, like, the wine cup was one thing, but people would also take tablets. Like, they would have pills made of solid antimony. And he would say, like, you know, this is a great lineage gift or something like that.
Okay.
So it's like, you just have one, and it's like, oh, that cures constipation if you have a problem with constipation. And then you get it later when you're done and clean it and give it to whoever else needs to take the antimony tablet, because it's just a solid brick of metal.
Yeah.
It's gonna... So...
That's and, nice. That's
yeah,
very
it's nice.
Nice.
He's
a very nice personal gift.
He's suggesting, you know, give it to you. It's for your sons and your son's sons.
Yeah.
For their digestive problems. Clearly, people in Rome did not have great diets. That's what I took away from this.
Well, son, I'm going to pass this on to you before I die.
This was good enough for your father and my father's father. We
this
shit this stone.
Me to shit for... in my neighbor's dog's bed. And you shall do it too, along with your sons.
This family has been shitting for 90 years with this pill. And God help me if you're going to be going around and taking antibiotics. That's not what this fit. I didn't raise you that way.
Oh, geez, thanks, Dad. And then he zooms off on, like, a hoverboard, because I assume we're in the...
Oh, we're... this was happening much more recently than I thought.
That was happening now.
It's happening, yeah.
That's why it's so good. Yeah, I've also been looking into stuff lately. Well, not super recently, but I think it was like last week or week four.
Yeah.
I've been looking up just because me and a friend were like, is there any like California supernatural legends? Because a lot of it happens up like north in like the Pacific Northwest, because that's like a hotbed.
Yeah.
Of course, the Southwest has like Chupacabra.
Sure.
And like other good stuff.
Jackalope.
Yeah, Jackalope, which... It's just dumb. It's just
the bare minimum of a mythological creature.
It's just, let's put one thing on top of another thing. It doesn't do anything.
Oh,
it looks cool.
It's just a rabbit with
horns. It looks neat.
Yeah, it looks neat. It doesn't even, like, have a magic. Does it do it? Does it have, like, a... Well, it's a rabbit.
No, but it's great for selling to tourists once, like, they pass through. I found, like... I think two things that were interesting. Oh. Everyone knows we have, like, a shit ton of haunted houses.
We do.
Well, for whatever reason. The only one that really interests me is the one where the person kept building and building stuff.
House.
Yeah, the Winchester House. Where, because voices told her to do it, and they would murder her family unless she saw them. So you get, like, cool windows that go to nowhere, like, just that are in the floor. And stairs that literally just drop off the roof or, like, go into the ceiling with no end. So that's neat. But the two things I remember finding was, I know it was some generic name. I want to say it was, like, the tall people or, like, and what it is in, like, the hills in, like, central California.
Mm-hmm.
You could see, like, at sunset, these really tall, like, just all black, just shades of tall people standing on top of these hills and doing nothing.
Oh, okay.
Just standing. Yeah, no one's, like, scared or anything.
It's just like, oh, yeah, those things.
Yeah, they're just there. And
the undying horror.
It's so obviously just an illusion, but it's, like, this thing was... I want to say it does go back to Native American times. Like, they had a name for it, too.
Okay.
But, yeah, no one ever says they do anything.
They just hang out.
They just stand there. And that's cool, I guess. But, like...
It's kind of like, just as an interjection,
sure.
It's kind of like... when the first Super Mario Galaxy, and they had those
sprites Hell Valley.
That they didn't use.
Yeah.
And it's
no,
just...
they use them.
Oh, did
they're
use
just
them?
Not doing anything. Like, they're just there.
They're just there on the ridge watching you. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
part of the... For anyone who doesn't know, it's called the People of Hell Valley. I forget what level it is, but if I saw it, I would be able to recognize it.
It's like a
which,
lava level.
Yeah, it is a lava level, which helps a lot for this podcast. But... In the background, and it in the background, if you take a look at a specific spot, you can see what looks like these very tall, like almost people that look like they're modeled after the screen painting.
Yes.
Yeah. Just kind of standing there and constantly watching you, and they do that because it's part of the actual background skybox.
Yeah, yeah.
So it never really moves; it just gives the illusion that it's staying there. And that's, yeah, that's always pretty cool. I always love
little... It is actually a really cool little Easter egg, too.
Yeah, I love, like, little video game stuff like that. There's this thing in FF14 where you go on a mission, right? Yeah. And it involves, like, a ghost of someone.
Oh, okay.
And once you complete that mission, you'll sometimes see that ghost.
Oh,
okay. Like, there's a percentage number, and it does a roll. And you have a slight chance of seeing it. But as soon as it appears... I think it only stays for, like, 2 or 3 seconds, and then immediately disappears.
Wow.
So you always, like, start questioning whether or not it's there or not.
It's really cool.
Yeah, it's really neat. It's really fucking neat.
Well, okay, I got one more Easter egg that's ghost-related from video game.
Okay, because I have another one.
Okay. Like... Oh, okay. There was a game that we all loved and cherished called Hitman?
Sure.
Hitman. Yeah, Hitman. And there was a level in which you're supposed to...
I think it's Hitman, too, because I think I know what you're talking about.
You're, like, supposed to throttle a man on a toilet or something
yeah.
like that. And then you look in... If you look in the mirror, there's a ghost in the shower.
Mm-hmm.
And you can shoot the ghost and kill the ghost.
Yeah.
And there's just an explosion of blood everywhere. And then I think the ghost kind of, like, follows you through that part of the hotel.
Yeah, through that specific area.
Yeah.
No, that's pretty neat. I think that's Hitman, too.
Because
I think it's all, too.
Yeah.
So, in Corpse Party... Mm-hmm. Which is, it's supposed to be a very spooky game anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Old computer game that was built on, like, RPG Maker.
Mm-hmm.
It made real good use of stuff. So now you can get on the Vita and, like, PSP and stuff.
Okay.
There's, in the first room you're in, there's like, this cabinet that's just filled with hair.
Okay.
Because the Japanese are horrified by hair.
Sure.
And nothing really happens when you check it. What you check it once, and it kind of just... gives you a big picture and like, oh, look, it's just filled with hair. But if you check it 3 times, you'll see a face show up in, like, the left cabinet. And it'll stay there for, like, 2 seconds and then, like, leave. And you can keep checking it as much as you want. It won't reappear.
That's really upsetting.
Yeah. And it's so... And it's unnecessary because you don't have to check that.
No.
Like, cabinet, which I love. Like, I love that I don't have to do that. It just helps with, like, the environment and stuff.
Sure. It makes you doubt yourself.
Yeah.
Okay, wait. Okay, I said that was the last one. But
sure.
There was a game that was actually, weirdly, it was a Nintendo game. And it was very...
Well, so was Super Mario Galaxy.
So was Super Mario Galaxy.
Yeah.
It was very adult.
Okay.
I would say, like, very gory and just upsetting. It was called something like Descent into Madness, I think is what it was called. Or something like that.
Are you... well, go on, describe it, because I might have an
it's
idea.
It's based on a kind of... It's very Lovecraftian, and...
Oh, it's Eternal Darkness.
Eternal Darkness,
yeah.
Descent into Madness.
For GameCube.
GameCube, yeah. And there's, like, there's an aspect of the game that is, the longer you expose your character to the upsetting things, mm-hmm. like, there's zombies and, like, just demon beasts, like, hell
yeah.
beasts. The longer you expose them directly to it, the lower their sanity meter
goes.
And if it gets too low, the game actually fucks with you, the player, like by turning the volume all the way off, or telling you that your files are being deleted on your entire system. Or,
like, you walk into rooms and all your limbs all of a sudden like explode before.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Or like the camera's upside down now. And...
The camera's upside down, or I think there's also ones where it, like, does... It changes the, not aspect ratio, but, like, the channel setting. So you're like, no, wait, this should be on the gaming setting. Why is it
Yeah,
on...
I think it does something like that. I also think at one point it just gives you an error screen.
Yeah, like it gives you an error screen.
Like, the disc just froze. Yeah, no, that game's pretty, pretty dope. If you can't get a hold of it, then I'm talking to people listening to this. The Super Best Friends did a playthrough of it.
Oh, okay.
And it's really awesome. That game is super interesting. It's got a lot of problems, don't get me wrong, but
sure.
it's really neat.
It at least had interest.
Yeah.
It.
It's one of those games where it just bit off more than it can chew. Like, honestly, that's what it comes down to. But no, it's super, super fascinating. Like, it's really just cool use of that animator. Okay, so back to some of the stuff I was looking into. So the only one that I found interesting here in California, right? They're called something like, they're called something like the Wishbone Walkers.
Oh, okay. What's
that? So there's only like two videos of them, right? Or at least two videos I could find. And it's a thing in Fresno.
Okay.
Or at least some people think it's located in Fresno, and I'll get to why people think. So the first video in Fresno, it just shows these two creatures that look like wishbones walking in, like, a big one followed by a smaller one. And I think there's one more in that video, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
And it's just, they literally look like wishbones.
So it's like a white arch and a line up the top?
Yeah, okay. Pretty much. And they walk super weird. Like, almost kind of, not fluid, but, like, you can see there's some structure in there.
Okay.
But kind of just walking around. I'm of the belief that it is fake, just because I've looked at the thing a couple times and just the way they walk.
Yeah.
I feel like it could be just a puppet apparatus or something. especially, I'm, like, confident the second video is fake, and that was taken in, like, Yosemite. That was, like, a ranger thing.
Yeah.
And the way they walked was very different from the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And that one was much more, like, rigid and stuff. That one was easily believable that you could just fake that. Like, or just make a kind of, like, I guess a puppet or some kind of thing like that. Or a costume. But I think it's neat.
I do think
just because I haven't seen any, like, supernatural creatures that are shaped like that.
No, I've not.
And they're just kind of weird. Like, it's, and again, one of those things where it's like, yeah, we don't know. they don't do anything. Something.
They're just out there. I mean, there's a handful of stories like that from like old fur trappers or even back to the colonial period.
Mm-hmm.
And like the weird thing is like sometimes like not to undersell, like our ancestors were afraid of ghosts and vampires and witches, but they also were afraid of like shit that like no one's ever heard of, and I don't know that it's like. Like, there's stories from fur trappers who talked about a thing called the Hide Behind.
Okay.
Which is just, like, he looks just like Slenderman, except that he just follows you, and then as soon as you turn, he's very good at, like, hiding behind things.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Willowy limbs, he can just shape himself like a tree or...
Yeah, I've heard about that, actually.
And so,
I didn't know it was called a hide behind. That's...
Yeah. We were very literal with
names. Sure.
There was also an animal that they claimed to see called the High Wolves, which were just wolves that had, like, stilt legs. So they were, like, 9 foot tall. And, like, the trick was... It was... like, the thing that people would fear was just, like, you gotta watch out for those High Wolves, because they'll wait for you to walk under them. And then they just dive down, and a wolf attacks you from 9 feet up. Which, that would be scary.
Yeah, it would. But how... If they have incredibly tall legs...
Like,
like they can't even run that fast.
Like, I think the idea
like giraffes
is,
can't run.
No, giraffes. Fast. Giraffes are the joke of nature. But, like, I think the idea is, like, they spread out their legs.
Uh-huh.
So the idea is you wouldn't notice them in the trees.
Okay.
And so you walk through them, and then once you're right underneath them...
That makes they, more like, sense.
Crook their knees and dive down.
Yeah, just kind of... Okay. Yeah, yeah. That makes more sense than... Me thinking they're standing super
they're like
tall,
stalking you,
and then they just kind of fall. And
like... No, I think that's what they were talking about. But yeah, like I do appreciate how literal most of Native American, North American legends are. Like Thunderbird, it's exactly what it sounds.
And Thunderbird's
like.
So fucking cool.
Thunderbird's
just
pretty tight.
A bird that shoots thunder. Lightning and thunder.
It's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing.
As a kid, I remember hearing that and going, "That's the fucking coolest thing ever."
I a slight segue. I did actually recently see that new Harry Potter movie.
Fantastic Beasts!
Fantastic Beasts.
Yeah, apparently you and the rest of the world. So like, yeah.
Yeah, sorry. So like, not to actually even talk about the movie directly, but just it was a good segue actually because they talk about Native American beastry and a lot of. Myths and things from Native American, and like so. There's the Thunderbird is in the film, and then there's the Horned Serpent, which it's supposed to control water. So it's got one up on the jackalope.
Okay,
so it's like a magic river.
It can actually fuck people up.
Yeah, it can fuck people up. And then it's got, I'm trying to think of the other two, but there's one creature called the Wampus, which is just a bobcat with six legs.
I want to say a name's familiar, but I didn't know. This is a bobcat with six legs. That's why I think I'm crazy.
And like here's what the power of the Wampus is. It's almost impossible to kill.
Okay.
That's the only power. It's
well,
like,
if it's almost impossible, what kills it? Like,
You just have to chop it into little pieces all at once, I think. Like, oh. It has, like, super regenerative powers.
Okay. Oh, okay, so one of those, okay.
Yeah, yeah, it's one of those things. But, like, other than that, like, that's almost not a power at all. That's right on the edge of... You're right on the edge of Bobcat. Not of... fucking Jackalope Town. Yeah.
Jackalope's so goddamn stupid. Okay.
But, Yeah,
but how was the movie? Cause,
how was the movie?
Yeah. Because I dropped off of Harry Potter super hard, like, years ago, but...
It's fair. I understand that.
I'll get into it after the movie, so how was the movie?
How's the movie? I thought it was good. It was good. It was not great.
Okay.
It was not amazing. I could go on a long list of reasons I thought it could have been better, but it was, like, fine. I'd say the things that didn't work... Here's the thing that worked best for it.
Okay.
Is that... do you remember, recently there was a book published called, Harry Potter and the Cursed Child?
Yeah, the play that you had to pay for to read?
Yes.
It's fucking horseshit.
Yes, it's bullshit. And, let me point out, J.K. Rowling didn't write that.
Okay, so that's confirmed?
Forgiveness for her. She just gave license to two playwrights to write
the play.
Sure,
okay.
And so, like,
she's not responsible for them going back in time and, like, fucking shit up. No. Because they were there the entire time.
What?
And the time turner apparently is way stronger and better than, like...
Apparently it can do more than a few hours, like, they established in...
Like, it'd be forever or some stupid shit.
Yeah,
like,
you could go back to the beginning of time. Just
you can literally just abort Voldemort and, like, the whole thing's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
Which, by the way, that I think you could have done with the original time turner. That was part of the reason I fell off, but...
But, so, yeah, that one's horseshit and stupid. Mm. But I'd say that one of the good things that this new film does, which is written by J.K. Rowling, she wrote the script, is there is an element of unraveling a mystery, which I think is at the center of good Harry Potter stories, is, oh, what is or who is X?
Yeah.
We have to do this whole story to figure out who or what is X.
Okay. So it's more of like a mystery.
It has mystery elements at the core of it.
Okay.
I think that's what makes a good Harry Potter story.
Yeah, that's always fun.
You know, my favorite Harry Potter, Prisoner of Azkaban.
That's my favorite, too.
It's like, the best one.
Which, by the way, I found out Wayne Barlow did, like, the concept art for it
really?
I was researching stuff. Wow. Yeah, so maybe that's why it was my favorite.
That could be. Also, the director was...
I forget the director.
Not Iñárritu, but he's Iñárritu's buddy from Mexico. Shit.
I don't know.
But it's a good director. And anyway, I like that movie a lot.
Okay.
Because it has a very clear set mystery. Is, you know, who's Sirius Black? What's important about him?
Mm-hmm.
Why is everyone so weird when they talk about Harry and Sirius Black in the same sentence,
yeah,
you guys? So, like, that had good forward momentum.
Yeah.
And that keeps the story going. So that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Then it has other points, which, not so much. Not as much.
You like anything that stands out? Or...
I'm going to say that the main thing is... I mean, I don't know
how... Should I put, like, a spoiler warning right now?
No.
Because I can tell you, okay. I probably won't watch it.
Okay.
But
you
I don't know if people...
You can put a spoiler warning if you want. Yeah, sure.
So, how long do you think it'll take to explain it?
Less than 5 minutes.
Okay. So, spoiler warning. I don't know. Skip until you stop.
Skip until I stop talking about Harry Potter. Like, the film is, like, one of the themes that it ended up being. I thought it was going to be, like, a conserve nature kind of film.
Okay.
Which seems reasonable. It's more like a accept people who are different than you.
Sure.
Film. Because, you know what, fuck it. You gave a spoiler warning. The main, like, threat is that there's going to be a second Salem witch trial in America, basically.
Sick.
And there's people who are trying to hunt down wizards and witches, and they want to burn them to death.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's actually... Now I'm kind of interested in watching.
And then J.K. Rowling introduces this thing that, for some reason, she never talked about before in any other book, that when wizards or witches repress their magic, they're the way that they were born. When they repress it, the magic comes out in violent kind of explosions of like dark energy.
They get really horny and like
they get really horny and and it creates like a the phrase they use is like a parasitic magical creature.
Okay.
And it just murders people from the frustration of not being able to let out the magic. And so, like, it's kind of a metaphor. Oh my god,
this is, it's such a metaphor for just gay rights and or LGBTQ.
It's a metaphor for LGBTQ, and also, huge spoiler, the character that you're trying to find who is afflicted with this is played by the only gay actor in the film. So, like, but I mean, also, like, when you're talking about, like, this repression and things like that, one weird thing is that you're kind of implying that when you repress people, the only natural response is that they are going to try and murder you.
Yeah.
But also that it's set in Harlem, and it's just full of white people. It's White Town in New York in the 20s.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know what was happening in Harlem in the 20s.
Yeah.
This is like, jazz is, anyway.
No, so but that the British.
The British. So that those two things are kind of like, not even, like,
wasn't the Harlem Renaissance going on at that time, or was that later?
The beginning of the Harlem Renaissance. Okay. It went from 20s to 40s. But, like, so the idea of having a metaphor about accepting people who are different when you only have white straight people.
Except one gay guy. Characters.
Because they're all playing straight
people,
to my knowledge, except for Grindelwald if they decide to. They're potentially, there's going to be 5 of these, right?
Okay. Fuck, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh, never mind. I'm kind
of
not.
This is 1 of 5. So there's going to be 4 more. And so potentially they're going to delve into, young Dumbledore being super gay for Wizard Hitler. And that's kind of the backbone of it. I'm simplifying it a lot.
Sure.
And so, oh, shit! Okay, one last spoiler. The only Irish actor who I'm blanking on his name, probably Colin, I'm gonna guess is his name. Irish guy, Irish face. It turns out he is actually a different wizard in disguise.
What?
He is the wizard Hitler in disguise.
What?
And the real guy is Johnny Depp with bleach blonde hair.
Oh, so he looks like a Nazi.
Yeah, he looks like a Nazi.
Yeah.
And so Johnny Depp is going to be the villain of this film series.
Okay, that's kind of cool.
And Johnny Depp is trying to... And the only person who can stop him is Dumbledore, who he's just dick-teasing enough to keep him from stopping him. That's kind of the plot.
Okay.
So I feel like I really wandered off the path there. The point being... Maybe have a gay character, and maybe have black people exist in Harlem in the 20s.
You can't mix two things. You can't have gay and black.
You gotta pick one! You gotta pick one, you guys! It's confusing to the audience!
Okay, and spoiler town over. So we'll stop talking about
that. All done talking about that.
Because I don't know, since we're talking about Harry Potter, just because a lot of people have been asking me, and I don't know if they listen to the podcast, like, why I'm not into Harry Potter.
Oh, yeah, why?
When apparently, like, a bunch of people... So I was. I read the books as they came out. I remember going to... Remember when Borders was at Stonewood?
Oh, yeah, there was a little express.
So they did a thing where they opened up, like, super early, before even the mall was open.
Oh, wow.
For Deathly Hallows. I remember asking my mom if, like, she could take me to go get it. And poor her, because we were, like, it was, like, 5 in the morning or so she takes me. I'm like the only one there, by the way. There was no line or anything. And I walk in, I buy the thing, which I pre-ordered because I was a dumb child, and like bought that. I think I bought one of those chocolate rats that they were selling, where it was like those novelty candies that weren't really that good. Never are. And like reading the book, and then I fell asleep, and then I kept reading it. And then once I finished the books, I felt done. Like, I didn't...
Oh, you felt like you'd done your work.
Yeah, and I tried staying with the movies, and after Order of the Phoenix, which I watched a long time ago, I remember not liking it when I was a kid, but I don't know if it was any good or not. Once that movie finished, I just dropped it. I didn't even care, about the movies anymore. And it was one of those things where I closed the book, and I was done, and... I felt finished.
I understand that.
I don't want to keep going.
You don't want to just drag out this thing. You know what? Yeah. I put in my time. I got to the end.
Yeah.
Time to find a new horizon.
Yeah. And I think that's when we started reading Pendragon.
Oh, too, for anyone I've read never it. Read those.
Oh, I really dug them. Yeah, I liked them more than Harry Potter as a kid.
Wow, okay.
I would have to go back and see which ones are better. Okay. But the whole premise of Pendragon was there's parallel universes, or not even like parallel universes, they're just different universes.
Oh, okay.
Although you do have parallel worlds of Earth, like there's Earth 1, Earth 2, and Earth 3.
Like Marvel, sure, yeah, sure. Or DC.
No. So the way Earth 1 and Earth 2 and Earth 3 work, it's all in the same timeline. But there's three specific points in Earth's history where they go off into in completely different directions.
Okay.
And different worlds have these points. And these are where kind of like these people are born. I forget what their actual names are. But they're basically to make sure that that point goes the way it's supposed to go.
Okay.
So the first point for Earth was the end of World War II. Mm-hmm. And specifically the Hindenburg incident.
Oh, okay.
They had to stop that. They had to let that happen.
Okay.
Because if they didn't know it was a Nazi, spy thing at the time.
Yeah.
And if that had gone back, it would, re-change the entire face of the world and whatever. So, stuff like that. And they would just fix stuff. And there was, pretty dope world.
Okay.
And at one point, there's an island that turns into a giant mech. And it's fucking dope. It's pretty neat. And there's one central bad guy who's just trying to change it so that not only is he king of every world, but of the entire multiverse. Multiverse and stuff. So maybe because he was so evil, I dug it.
For sure.
And I tend to like villains that are just so into it. Like, they can't just be evil to me, they have to love being evil.
Just
like they're fucking into it,
I mean, it's my job, but I do this on the weekends, too.
Yeah. Like, that's why I think I like Dio from, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure so much. Because he fucking loves being evil, and it's fucking great. But yeah, I remember reading that a lot. I wonder if I still have the books. I'm pretty sure I do.
I'm sure.
Yeah, but those are neat reads. I know he came out with other stuff for it. I never dug into those. I never got into them, because I think they came out way later once I had,
For sure.
Finish the thing. It's did you know, a Captain Underpants came out, 2 years ago?
Something,
and the series is still going?
I only know that because I work in a school.
Okay.
So
I didn't know. Yeah. So, that's way too late, man.
This is, that shit was coming out when I was in elementary school.
Yeah. Yeah. That's,
So that has to be a solid 20-ish years that they've been happening.
Yeah, that he's been doing that shit.
Fuck.
It's nuts. But yeah, I'm trying to think. Oh, so back to the research thing.
Yeah.
The only other thing I was getting to, and I think we talked about it at our mutual friend's birthday, which, by the way, you didn't stay late enough, but I put a song on the playlist I made for that party.
Oh,
And there, and that song's going to be the end of this episode. Oh. I'll show it to you because I am excited. I'll just give you one artist that's in it.
Oh, please.
DMX. Is in the song, so God, I wish Nick was here. We can just do DMX quotes.
We can just stop, drop, and open up shop.
Yep, fucking bitches, great and all. But you ever tried garlic bread? One of my favorite lyrics to any of his songs. I got blood on my hands because I feel no remorse. I got blood on my dick because I fucked a corpse.
What the fuck? Can I?
Oh, DMX is best.
You know what? Yours might top one of my favorite rap lyrics. One of my favorite lyrics ever is there's a song called Energy by Drake.
Okay.
That he just let out like maybe a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
All of that song I could deconstruct.
Sure.
I could really get into it. There's two parts. There's one part where he sings, I got girls in my life, and they all versions of me. I got strippers in my life, and they all versions of me. I don't know what that means, Drake. Do you see yourself in the... Why? What are they just... Do they look kind of like... I don't...
Maybe it's like Drake's inner, like, conflict. He wants to be a stripper.
His other one is... I can't remember the exact line, but it's something like... I got two mortgages with two houses and stuff like that. And he's just saying about how...
That's not good. That's not a good thing.
The challenges of his life.
Sure.
And it's like, Drake, this is not a relatable problem. No one made you get a mortgage on your house.
My solid gold toilet. Locked up.
It's so hard to be me. Drake, your life is great. Don't complain.
The 1% are suffering, two people. But you know. Okay, so back to the research, because I know someone's going to get mad if I don't finish this one.
Yeah.
So, and we were talking about this at our mutual friend's party. I was looking into, like, old Hebrew, like, stuff. And, like, yeah, I'm looking into your religion.
Sure.
Why didn't you ever tell me about the badass shit that's in, like, the afterlife, man?
Oh, yeah.
It's awesome. So there's a realm called Sheol.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it's not exactly purgatory. It's just where a lot of dead spirits go.
It's most where most people will probably go. Yeah,
it's not a bad thing, and it's not a good thing.
It's just where you go.
It's just where you go, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that part's cool and all because I dig the idea that no, you're all just going to the same place.
Everyone dies. Everyone dies. It's the same. It doesn't matter.
But according to like the Canaanites and like really old stuff, it's implied that Sheol is just a big fucking giant who turned into this afterlife.
Oh, like it is the spirit of some dead giant?
No, it is the giant.
Oh, it is the giant.
Yeah.
We're inside of a...
Yeah, or something like that.
Oh, wow.
That's awesome.
That's amazing.
That's fucking metal, dude. Like...
Judaism's mythology is fucking crazy.
Yeah.
It's insane. Like, you know...
You guys, like, I'm not gonna say you guys, just because it's...
You know you people.
But you know the good ones. No, but, like, Hebrew, seems to have this weird obsession with, giants. Like, there's a lot of...
Yeah.
Like, just... And they happen to be giants.
Yeah. I mean, did you ever hear about the book of, Enoch, who's, like, he's mentioned in Genesis and...
Yeah, I've heard that name thrown around. I don't know.
So like, I actually was reading on. Was reading on this specific thing.
Yeah.
There was a people called the Nephilim.
Yeah, and, yeah.
Yeah. Have you heard about this?
Yeah. Aren't they just again forms of giants or something?
They're specifically. So this is after Lucifer, but before the flood.
Okay.
There were other angels in heaven.
Yeah.
Who were like, you know what? This isn't working out for me. And they.
Like a neutral party.
A neutral party. Yeah. They were like, you know, I'm not into Satan, but I'm also into vagina. This is specifically, I'm paraphrasing. But, so they went to Earth, and they made themselves meat bodies.
Yeah.
Because also, one thing to mention is, Hebrew angels aren't people-like.
No.
Angels aren't anything like people.
No.
They are like, if you ever watch Eva, that's actually what angels are supposed to
look
like.
Yeah, they're like crazy, almost monster-like.
They're like gemstones made of light.
Yeah, two wheels spinning that just
wheels,
made of eyes.
Made of eyes.
Yeah.
Wings.
A head that's
wings.
Just a face. That's just like a face with wings in it.
Or there's actually angels that actually sound quasi-demonic even. Like there's angels that are like, it has four faces that face each north, south, east, and west. And one is a bull and one is a lion. And yeah. It's crazy shit. So... The angels came to Earth, and then they made meat bodies, and they just gave it to a bunch of human ladies.
Oh, yeah.
And the human ladies gave birth to human-angel hybrids, and Nephilim, and they were giants.
Yes.
and then, like, it's implied that just, like, inherently they are, like, abominations. Like, these are just against nature. This shouldn't be happening.
Yeah.
And so, like... You know, just, like, up the butt. All kinds of the stuff that God just gets mad about.
Yeah.
Just, and then the Book of Enoch is kind of, like, leading up to, oh, my grandson Noah is probably going to have to build a boat. No spoilers on that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, yeah, that kind of thing. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sure.
There's crazy amazing stuff in there. It's,
awesome.
It's... What other kinds of things?
That's pretty much it. There was one, I'm trying to remember the name, Refame, or Refames, or Refems.
Refames?
Yeah. I'm trying to remember what they actually were, because I just remember the names.
Well, I can tell you, I'll just try and jog my memory on some Hebrew mythologies. I remember that there's a lot of talk about... Well, I mean, there's basically a lot of talk about how... we're the chosen people.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys.
Yeah.
And so, like, there's this weird element, there's a lot of weird elements that I can't unpack right now. But,
sure.
It's
the Bible.
But one part of it was that, like, we thought that because we're the chosen people, like, that Jews have an innate nature of, like, magic. That's the only way.
Uh-huh.
Like, we have a right to tap into God's power and do magic. That's what it is. And so, like, you have the stories, like, the Golem is probably the most well-known in a lot of stories, which is the story of...
Which is another, it's a giant.
It's also a giant. It's
not that big of a giant, but it's considered a giant.
Smaller than the Nephilim, but bigger than people.
Bigger than people.
And it's like a clay or a mud man that a rabbi makes to, like, get revenge. That's literally all they're made for, is revenge.
What a holy man.
What a holy man. If God says it's cool, then it's cool.
Then
well,
it's
also,
cool.
Don't forget, like, Jewish God is super into revenge.
Yeah,
like,
he's super vengeful. This is a guy who flooded an entire world.
Flooded an entire town. There's a part in... I don't know why people don't talk about it more, because this blows my mind.
Okay.
There was two tribes of Israel lost half their people when they're being led through the desert by Moses.
Okay.
Because they complained so much that God got tired of them complaining and opened the earth and shut it to crush them because they wouldn't shut the fuck up. Like, that's the kind of guy you're dealing with. And I don't know why people don't talk about that more. Like, it's legitimate. Like, it's not because they sinned. It's not because they did anything. It's just like, shut the fuck up. I'm God and you don't question me.
Don't turn around or else you're going to be a pillar of salt.
Yeah. Oh my God.
She did nothing. Like.
Yeah, she did nothing. She...
Maybe she smelled like a fart or something. It was trying to find the source.
What if someone tapped her on the shoulder and was like, hey, Beth. What? Oh, damn it.
You ever think, you ever hope for, because I hope for this, that there would be, since I like this genre of games,
yes.
I hope for a Bible fighting game. Like a legitimately good one. But I want the old shit. Like, I want, well, Jacob's got to be in there.
Because
Jacob's, like, the baddest motherfucker.
He wrestled an angel and won.
For days.
For 40 days.
I don't know if he won, but I know the angel gave up.
The angel...
Because he was, like, sick of the shit.
You know what? I have angel stuff to do, guys. I gotta, you know, sing.
They had a ladder match. It was fucking awesome.
I've never heard anyone phrase it that way, and now I'm only gonna think of it that way.
Oh, that's how I think of it, because it's great.
I just want to imagine that Jacob referred to everyone as brother. That would make it really great. I'll tell you something else, brother.
He does he does an angel off the high ropes, and like Jacob's just doing a hurricanrana and like but I want like Jacob, I want a Nephilim. I would love a Golem,
sure,
like, and I would want one of those angels, like the monstrous looking ones that are described in like
full angels.
I mean, you gotta have Lucifer in that,
sure,
and then he can like have a form where he's then the devil or like Satan.
Sure, yeah. You have hot guy devil and evil guy devil.
Yeah, an evil guy devil.
Yeah.
God, like, I would love.
Would it be like an old fashioned arcade match game? Like,
just a 2D,
super pixely.
I would love an SNK style sprites with just shit ton of animation and like.
And they would all be able to, like, throw fireballs and stuff like
that. Everyone could throw a fire. Like, well, except Jacob, but Jacob wouldn't need it. He would be Jacob would be the grappler of, like,
the game. Oh, sure. Like, he does, like, the thighs around your neck and then, like, yeah, slam you down.
You have to do, like, 360s and 720s on the stick. It would just be super cool. I would love it for this kind of game.
I'd really like if one of the characters' only power is, I have a rock! And then he just throws.
Yeah. We could just have David and.
Oh, he's just, what?
Yeah.
King David, yes.
We could just, No, but I want Kid David.
Oh, young little.
Yeah,
okay.
He has to be a zoning projectile character. Okay. He uses rocks and slings.
He's mostly defense.
Yeah, but... and he's naked the entire time. I'm just basing it off the statue, but.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, we have to stop having conversations that end with naked children. This is not a pattern of being.
That was a giant, like, oh my god. I would love, like, Abraham's in it, and sure. Abraham's whole thing is, he does, like, double damage if he hits him in the back. Or, like, something like that.
Can I say, actually, you've reminded me a little bit of, David Mitchell sketch.
Okay.
From this had to be like 10 years ago now. Fuck. But he had this reoccurring sketch that was really funny called "The BMX Bandit and Angel Summoner."
Okay.
And like the sketch was basically like one of those buddy team up kind of things. Like, oh, I specialize in this thing, and he's specialized in our combined talents really help us beat up the bad guys, such and such. But one guy is a BMX expert, and the other one can summon angels to do his bidding. And like every time, it was just like, all right, angel summoner, here's my plan. I'll do a backflip off of that railing, knocking the gun out of the terrorist's hands. That way, in the distraction, you can untie the hostages. Or I could just, you know, like, summon a horde of angels to kill them all. I mean, I guess we could do that, but I won't.
Okay, so I think we should move on to the next thing.
No problem.
Although I could talk about crazy Bible shit.
Oh, forever. Day in, day out.
Oh. Okay, so we're gonna change things up a bit. I was already telling Ian before we started. Instead of doing the story thing, just because we are missing Nick, and I feel like that would cut the podcast really short if it was just me and you saying it, I wanted to just talk about stuff about writing, like, and telling stories. So we'll start with like a pretty simple question that I think is always fun. What are some of your favorite tropes? Like we all kind of have this disdain for tropes and that, oh, it's kind of tropey and stuff, but come on, there's tropes that we were like, yeah, I like saying that, or like, that's always fun. While you're thinking, I'll go off on the first one. One of my favorite things to see in television and, like, basically TV, is the episode where they all do a play.
Yes.
Or, like, put on a movie and just do this kind of stuff. Like, in Avatar The Last Airbender, I think the best episode is when they do the recap.
They do the recap
and, play. But it's all in the play form, and it's all, like,
all the details
misconstrued.
Are wrong.
Yeah. And, next to the Sexy Beach Day episode they have. Like,
Sexy Beach Day is very fun. I mean, Avatar is a weird, just as a comment on Avatar's writing in general, is Avatar succeeded in having no filler, in my opinion.
Well, Beach Day isn't Beach Day, I consider.
I mean, it's filler, but like I think that everything served purpose. Nothing was just dead.
Sure,
dead
there was something at the end that gave you, like, it moved the character this way,
or it set up something for later. I mean, even the episode with Tales from Ba Sing Se, where it's just like four short stories.
Oh no, that's another one where it's like my favorite. That's another trope I tend to like, where they just do a bunch of short stories of these characters.
I really love that.
Yeah,
yeah, it was.
No, that one had purpose because that was Appa missing and like them trying to find it.
That's true.
And Sokka doing the haiku contest.
That was lovely.
It's
I
fucking
really
great.
Enjoyed that.
They hit you with Momo sleeping in the pad, like where Appa was sleeping.
And then, I mean, I got hit also by Iroh missing his son.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Fuck, dude. Iroh's like one of my favorite characters.
Iroh's
in that
an amazing
thing.
Character.
Dude, he that scene, where he's just in jail, and like. He's faking, like, being just this,
ill old man.
Yeah, this old man. And he's just working out. Like, he's just getting strong. He's not practicing firebending or anything. He's just getting really buff.
Yeah.
And they come back to save him, and the whole place is, like, fucked up and destroyed. And then they find a guard, and he's like, where the hell was he? It's like, it was like a tank moving, or, like, something like that. And there's no burn marks or anything. It's just he ripped the bars up in there, which is fucking...
Just with his bare muscle.
Yeah, which is fucking awesome.
It's amazing. I think that... I really liked the sequel series, Korra. I dug it, too. But I think one thing that it would have done, maybe...
It's another trope I'm going to get into is something Korra does.
So okay.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
I think one thing that it could have benefited from was... It didn't have the room to breathe that I think Avatar did.
No, I don't think it did.
It was because it was 12 episodes. Mm-hmm.
Each season was more defined, we start a story this season, that's the end of this season.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was. But I think it's too bad because sometimes you did have moments that felt congested or I hate to say rushed, but sometimes it did feel a little rushed at moments. I mean, I'd say like the reveal of her dating each of her team members, you know what I mean? Like, starts with Bolin, kind of, and then goes out with Mako, and then ends with the rich girl.
Asami.
Which
I do like. I do like that they're...
But it did feel like their relationship felt very abrupt to me. I don't know if you felt that way.
I don't think so, because it's never implied that her and Asami, like... it's never explicitly shown, like, they're going at it.
Yeah.
The only hint that you get is that they're both just kind of, like, besties, like, at the end. And, like,
I mean, they look at each other in a way that
that's where I'm getting at. Yeah, like, towards the end, though, you start seeing those looks, and they decide to go together into, like, the spirit world.
Right.
And they're holding hands and stuff like that.
But, like, so, I'm thinking of early in that season, when she has...
Yeah, I think it's only relegated to that season.
When she's exiled herself and she's gone, and then she comes back, right?
Yeah.
And she comes back, and you find out that, the only person she was writing to was Asami.
Mm-hmm.
And Mako's reaction, at least, felt very threatened by that.
Mm-hmm.
That was my interpretation. And that's when I was like, oh, okay, I see what's going on there. And I felt, I don't know, I felt like that could have been... opened up to air a little bit better. I don't know. I felt the same way about the relationship between... There was a little Earth Nation kid who became an airbender and started dating...
Earth Nation kid who became an airbender.
He became... Like, because in the third season, all these people became airbenders. Oh, Opal. Yeah, and he started going out with... he started going out with one of Aang's grandchildren, I guess.
No, that's not Opal. I know the little boy kid you're talking about.
Yeah. They started kind of being a thing.
Yeah, it just kind of seemed like just little kid puppy love.
It was puppy love, but okay, yeah, I guess when you put it that way, you're like...
But that's my cynical side of me of going, kids are stupid.
They don't know what they want.
Yeah, they don't know what they want. So, like, I know a lot of people don't particularly like Korra, but to me, whenever I heard that argument, they just seemed to like things about Avatar that even I'm like, that's kind of... I don't dig that. Like, I like that Korra goes for kind of a more mature audience, not necessarily adult, in that, like, the original viewers are grown up now.
Yeah.
For Avatar. And this is where we get to one of my tropes that I like, is when everyone is sick and tired of cleaning up after superheroes.
Yes.
Sick of... Like, because in the first season they address that, where, hey, you realize you froze, like, the river, and this thing we have to clean up now, and figure out how the fuck we're going to get water moving back.
So many boats that we can't get to.
Anymore. Yeah, but I caught the bad guy. Sure, but we can't, like, eat anymore, is the deal. And I always do tend to side with the heroes if the bad guy is really fucking bad.
Right.
But that's just me going to any... the ends justify the means type deal. But I love when people get fed up with that shit, like, just sick of putting up, like,
I live in vines now. My house is full of vines.
Like, Civil War is totally based on that, like, just that entire deal. And, like, yeah, Korra did it really well. My whole thing with, like, Korra is I do agree. I hate the second season. I think it's just boring. Like, see, I don't even remember much of what happened in the second season, which is not a good sign. Except it has the two best episodes.
Which are?
In all of Avatar, in my opinion.
Okay.
Well, two of the best. The Avatar Juan.
Oh, scene. That's excellent.
Two episodes done in Miyazaki-like art style. And his whole thing, it's an awesome character and, like, still done in kind of, like, this old-timey style. Yeah. Like, very traditional. Mm-hmm. But you get to see all the cool creatures and, like, it's just kind of really wonderful.
And the amount of detail that went into the structure of the narrative to reflect everything we have already learned about avatars and their
It seemed like a pretty natural progression. And,
yeah.
And like done in two episodes. So I watched that and I think that's what ruined second season even more for me. So I'm like, you can do it. You can tell this story. You can tell these stories. And they do it in the third season, in my opinion. Because the third season's like the best season.
It's tight. It's a tight story.
Dude, and that's where you get to another one of the tropes I tend like. We'll come back to the other one if you have something to say about it. Is the villain reveal.
The villain
reveal? Or character reveal, I like to call it. Mm-hmm. I love it. I hate when you tell me that the villain's bad. Like, I have to see it. And one of my favorite things is I just see a real quick, sell me on the character. Mm-hmm. You have, like, a minute. Go. And the way they sell each character, it's not a minute, but they give you a scene of just them breaking out of jail.
Yeah.
And they do it in such crazy and nuts manners that you go, these people have to go. Like, they are fucking terrible and dangerous. Yeah. And they just wreck shit so hard. And I fucking love that. Like, the first four episodes, each episode, like, I think one of the bad guys, like, gets, like, their turn at breaking out of jail. And they all, and I think while one of them helps, like, you can tell, like, they still give the main guy breaking out, like, a lot of weight in what he has to do. And I fucking love that. Like, seeing the villain be bad. Like, one of my favorite things in JoJo, when you realize Dio, he gives you a bunch of stuff that Dio's just awful, is he jumps, one of the first thing he does, he knees the shit out of a dog, like, that just comes out of him. And it's done in, like, this crazy style. And you're like, oh, what the fuck? Like, he comes out of nowhere. And he eventually goes on to murder the dog. And that's not even spoilers, because that's, like, later that episode. And that's, like, episode two.
Yeah.
This guy's bad. Like, this
real bad guy.
Yeah. And I dig that. I love that trope.
Oh, absolutely. Talking about a different trope that I'm really fond of, actually, is the bottle.
Bottle episodes?
Bottle episodes. I think bottle episodes are actually really... They show how strong a writer you are.
Okay. How so?
If you can make people sitting in a room talking interesting...
Okay.
...for the length of your episode. Because there are shows where they have bottle episodes and I can't watch it.
Yeah.
Because I don't actually... And that's really fucking sad. You know what? Here's maybe the most controversial thing I've ever said on the show. So...
Sure.
Buckle the fuck up. So, bottle episodes on Friends don't work for me at all.
See, I don't even like Friends.
I can't watch it. I can't watch that show.
I simply think it's because I'm not wide enough. But
you know what? That's probably what it is.
It's
compliments.
It's not that. I've seriously tried. I really have tried to give Friends, like, my time of day, and, like, I think I've watched four episodes now. And, yeah, I don't know. I just don't. I'm not into any of the characters. No. They all, to me, it's all like, oh, your lives are going great. Shut up. Like, why is any of this bad?
This is, it's the Laura Dunham of problems. It's like, what, shut the fuck up. Just shut the fuck up.
But yeah, go on with the Bob episode, because I know the big arguments against Bob episodes. I want to see, like.
Oh, well, I mean, I just think that it's ultimately a show of, it's a show-off-y thing, I think is what it is.
Yeah, okay.
And I acknowledge that, but I like that about
sure.
it. Is,
well, if it's a good story, it's a good story.
If it's a good story, it's a good story.
Plus, you can have bottle episodes that do, like, add on to the character.
You can, yeah.
And that's usually, if done right, like, that's what a bottle episode should probably do.
I think that maybe the best example of that is Dan Harmon has done like five for Community. He did like five. There's three D&D episodes. There's
all the D&D episodes are so fucking good. These are my favorite episodes.
I love them. And it's but the thing is, like, when people talked about how good the D&D episodes is, I got excited because I was like, oh, are they gonna do like a cutaway fantasy to them acting? No,
it's they're just them sitting,
talking about just like D&D.
Yeah. And it's awesome.
And it's great. It's amazing.
Yeah.
They have had, they had episodes, and then they had episodes like when Chevy Chase was in a cast and someone is accused of stealing. I don't know if you remember that. And they lock themselves in the study room.
Okay.
There's another bottle episode. They, I, to my memory, they've done at least five on Community, and all of them were engaging narratives that did interesting things with characters. And
Does Pillow, does, Pillow Fort and Blanket Fort count?
You know what? It's damn close, but I'm gonna only count the redo, the war documentary of it, not the actual war.
I'll buy into that then.
Okay.
Because I love those episodes.
It's such a good episode.
Yeah.
It's really, I mean, just the reading Shirley's emails in an old timey
and they do that documentary thing where it has the letter playing.
It's panning through with lots of like fade in, fade out photographs of things that happen. My dearest Laura, I don't know when I'll ever see you again. Oh my god, yeah.
Oh, go ahead.
No,
I know like the big argument against bottle episodes is they add nothing to the plot, like, and if. And I, you know what, I can buy that argument's fair if the show is plot-heavy.
Yeah, if it's plot-heavy.
If it's incredibly plot-heavy, like, I would hate to have a bottle episode. And unless the bottle episode was amazing. Like, it would have to be really fucking good in order to do that. Like, I think bottle episodes work great for comedy shows.
They work great for comedy shows, and they work... You're right, I think they tend to work... It's easier to do it for an episodic.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it works better for Community, because there's not necessarily, like...
There's no overarching plot or something. Yeah. They're all going to be in college forever.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, it's lasting forever.
Yeah.
But, like, yeah, I wouldn't want to watch that on, I don't know, Westworld. And they're just in one room.
I have to watch Westworld.
I haven't seen it yet either.
I have to watch it.
I've just heard Anthony Hopkins is, of course, amazing.
So. I didn't even know he was in there until, like, 2 days ago. So now I'm, like, incredibly excited to see Anthony Hopkins in.
Do you want to know what someone picked? Because I hadn't heard anything about it. Here's the pitch I was given for why to watch Westworld. It's Jurassic Park with cowboy robots.
Yep. Yeah, there you go.
Well,
the thing that sold on me is one of the podcasts I listen to. They're talking about how they explore, like, the Turing test and all that.
Oh.
And to me, I'm like, oh, fuck, okay. Like, I'm interested in that. I love that. I love the idea of the Turing test and, like, just how close AI gets to replicating humans. But, yeah, those are some pretty good tropes. I'm trying to think of other examples. Oh, another good, like, sell me on the characters is, I think, Redline, which... does not have the best story in the world. In fact, like, that story's not great. That movie is very style over substance. It's just kind of like a fun watch.
Okay.
But they give you, there's this one shot, there's this one scene where one of the racers is just watching TV, and on the television they're just giving quick things about the racers.
Yeah.
And so they give, like, these little shorts of each racer, and they sell you hard, like, on them. Because each thing is, like, super different.
Sure.
You have the guys that are basically Batman and Robin.
Mm-hmm.
Like, 66 Batman and Robin duo. Okay. They have their own music, and it sounds, like, very much like that kind of song. Then you have these two, like, chicks that are also pop singers, and then they sell you on that. By even playing, like, a song they made and how they incorporate it into the racing.
Okay.
So, and then you just have the big bad guy who's just a dude stroking, like, this little Pomeranian. And, like, just looking real and just saying shit like that. Like, I love that. I love scenes where you just sell me on the characters real quick.
So it's wacky races.
Yeah.
Okay.
It really is. You should give it a shot. It's really, like, it's really fun to watch. I have a really specific complaint about that movie, which I honestly think they could have done without.
Okay.
But go watch it first, because I don't want to, like,
okay,
ruin that thing for it. It'll probably become very obvious to you.
Okay.
If it happens. But yeah, those are some good tropes. I'm trying to think of like anything else.
Film tropes that I'm a big fan of.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, one thing that you can get in trouble with. Okay, here's a thing that I do like. You can get in trouble with if you do it wrong or too much is addressing the fourth wall.
Yeah,
I love a good address of the fourth wall.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm probably thinking about it because I just recently watched the Holy Grail again.
Okay.
A few days ago.
Yeah.
And that one has some of my favorite fourth wall breaks, I think, of any film.
Sure.
Particularly, I mean, it's not even. Because the fourth wall breaks aren't, the fourth wall breaks aren't just like a character turning the camera like winking saying something. The fourth wall breaks are, for the first half hour of the movie, it's being narrated by this stuffy English guy, and then they show you him in his like tweed jacket and his glasses, and it captions like, history professor of Oxford College.
Yeah,
and at some point the characters run by and decapitate him with a sword, and then just a woman screams running into the frame off camera, Harold, no! And then they periodically cut back to, like, police cars and people taking notes in the field. It's such a dumb joke. It's, and, I mean, doing interesting, smart fourth wall breaks like that, I think that people, I don't want, and don't take this as a criticism, but, like, people want to do Ferris Bueller too much.
Yeah.
Ferris Bueller did Ferris Bueller. Let him be.
Yeah. And I fucking love you, Ferris Bueller.
Ferris, we love you. Yeah. We love you, Ferris. We all love Ferris.
Yeah.
But I think that too many people, when they do something like that, they want to be that.
Yeah, they want it really bad. Like, and they overreach for it.
They want to be Ferris Bueller.
Yeah.
I mean, they want to be... I'm kind of a cool rogue who like nods and winks the camera and I'm cool.
Yeah.
And well, I mean, if that makes sense for your character, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
But also, one, make sure it makes sense for your character, and two, please stop writing every character as that in a film like that.
Yeah.
I'd say the other best example of fourth wall nodding is probably Arrested Development's writing.
It has.
And I mean, that shit comes consistently. That's like once an episode at least.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Tobias says, you know, I bought myself a new phone because I'm an actor and I deserve something nice. And the narrator immediately says, he wasn't and he doesn't. Like, just that does nothing for the narrative. That's just to be mean to a character.
Shit on a character.
But,
But yeah, that's a very, it's a very tricky, like, high rope to walk. Like,
yeah,
because, yeah, you have to decide what amount you go for. Like, Deadpool's great,
mm-hmm.
but first of all, Deadpool was built on, like, that foundation.
Yeah.
Because he goes full ham.
He does, yeah.
He goes full ham, and he still keeps the narrative going.
And he acknowledges, like, this is for your entertainment.
Yeah.
This is not real. There's no real stakes, except for me, because I'm pretend.
Yeah.
And also, I know I'm pretend. So, I mean, yeah, that's something really good.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very excited for the sequel. Have you
me
heard
too.
About that?
Although it does seem like to be kind of rocky.
Does it?
With production right now. I don't know if you know the director left.
I did.
Yeah, he's going to be filming the Sonic the Hedgehog movie.
What?
I'm not even like joking about.
Shut your goddamn. Who's playing Sonic the Hedgehog?
I don't know. It's not Michael J. White, probably.
Oh, that's too bad. Yeah. I'd watch.
I don't know. The guy who does him now, I think, is fine. Like, who does the Sonic voice?
Sure.
He does Chris Redfield in like the Resident Evil games. So.
Oh yeah.
So like, what it was is they had like he left because of creative differences or something like that. Which basically means they got into an argument
with Ryan Reynolds.
With Ryan Reynolds, yeah, who's like heading the thing. I forgot who they got to replace the director.
I don't know who they got, but I know that they got John Hamm from Mad Men
to play. Yeah, which is awesome.
He's going to play
Cable.
Cable, yeah. I'm very excited.
I believe in John Hamm. I just didn't see that for Cable.
I mean,
for his Cable, I don't. Well, maybe because it's the comics and me going, yeah, doesn't Cable have to be a big, like, because
he's
like,
kind of a square shaped man,
yeah.
But I don't know how. Like, my thing is, he needs to be bigger than Deadpool, so
yeah.
I don't I don't know if they're going to just use apple crates or what. Because I can't picture what's the height difference between those two.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how tall
Sean
Hamm is, like, compared to him. But yeah. Yeah, so those are some good tropes. Oh, I didn't mention one of my favorite examples of the play within a show is my favorite episode of It's Always Sunny is
The Nightman Cometh.
I love that episode so much that I've always, like, tried. It's kind of like this dream to put on a production
of
The Nightman Cometh.
A full length version.
Yeah. Or, like, the one they actually did, like, a version of that. I don't know if you've seen that thing.
Oh, yeah, I have. We watched it, I think.
Oh, yeah, we did. Okay. Yeah. Something like that. I would kill to, like, yeah. And I would love to play Charlie, like, in the thing.
Just to tie together two threads that I hope that everyone out there looks for. Online, there's this great... Vine is dying. But there's a Vine that I really like of that scene in The Nightman Cometh, and then they play the Yes song from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Okay.
Roundabout. They play Roundabout, where it's... Frank says, "What the hell is that?" "You know what it is, bitch!" That's one of my favorite scenes.
did you watch the last season of It's Always Sunny, not the one that's currently going, the one before?
I probably did. I watch it so sporadically I can't tell.
Did you see the episode where they have the health inspector comes in?
No, I haven't seen
it. Okay, so look up that episode, because that might be the new best episode in my opinion. That season's okay, but that episode is fucking awesome.
Fuck.
Like, it's hilarious.
One of my favorite, I think one of the high points for me is, well, any episode that involves guns, but secondly, the Maureen Ponderosa to the McPoyle wedding.
Yeah.
That's such a self-indulgent, insane thing that happened. Just like, I mean, that was an Ouroboros. That was clear. I feel like that was very much for fans.
Yeah.
So much of that. But just the Guillermo del Toro is in it.
Yeah.
And he is an insane man who ate babies, apparently. Or maybe he didn't. I don't know.
Maybe we don't know. Yeah.
We don't know. He could just be crazy. And then he runs away crying in the middle of a wedding. Yeah. And oh my god.
I wonder if that episode came out after Pacific Rim. Or was it like during production? So that's the only way I can see him and Charlie Day,
like meeting each other.
Yeah, and getting it.
It had to have come out. No, it had to come out later, because Charlie Day had met that English guy from Torchwood.
He was in this episode. Yeah.
He was in the Flowers for Algernon.
Yeah, Flowers for Algernon.
Yeah. Which was also.
Yeah. Oh, Charlie's just nuts. We don't know why he's doing this thing.
He just became
he became so egotistical and, like, up his own ass. Fuck, that show was great.
I want to reiterate, these sounds mean absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
the reveal of his invention is also pretty fucking funny. What was it? It was a telephone that lets spiders talk to cats.
Yes.
He's so proud.
It's really great.
But what was one last thing?
Sure.
What was funny is, let's talk about deconstructing a little bit, because I love deconstructing.
Okay.
Is there's this weird thing when I watched that episode Flowers for Algernon, and the episode where they go to therapy.
Mm-hmm. I love it.
It's great.
We just want you to choose who does the dishes.
I've been keeping files on D for years. I keep files on everyone.
I love how Dennis has just become this incredible psychopath.
He's clearly a murderer.
Yeah.
He's just on the...
He's a murderer. He's probably a rapist,
probably.
Although it never...
The implication.
Yeah, the implication. The implication is, like, one of the darkest, like...
It's so... Because even the other people in the group are like, Charlie, that sounds really upsetting.
No, Dennis.
Dennis, that sounds really upsetting. No, you, I'm not...
And they sit on that, like... They do that scene for so, like, a very uncomfortable amount of time.
Yeah, they do.
Oh, I love I love it. Oh, yeah, sorry.
But, just the I think that there, between those two episodes, Charlie's character actually does seem to have a heartbreaking amount of self-awareness that mm-hmm. he just chooses not to voice.
Yeah.
He seems to know that his friends are garbage people and that he's treated like shit all the time. Because, I mean, like, there's that scene in the bar when they're trying to catch a rat.
Uh-huh.
Do you remember that? And
yeah, and he gets a bat with, like...
And he basically just says, I'm not going to wait. Sit around and watch you all fumble for a week trying to catch a rat and then just end up huffing fumes. He doesn't do it. And then that is exactly what ends up happening. They just get a can of gasoline and huff fumes up. Apropos of nothing! So I think that there is, like, a weird... Like, out of all the characters... I mean, Charlie is probably the sweetest of the characters also, mm-hmm. but...
He's the only one that's redeemable.
He's the only redeemable
And he's,
person.
Like, the... And he's probably the only good person, like, on... The...
Rickety Cricket, maybe.
Yeah. I don't know.
I mean, does this look like a dog's vagina to you?
I'm talking, like, main... I'm talking, like, main cast.
Oh, main character,
because,
yeah.
Because if we start getting into that, well... We could just say they fucked up everyone.
Oh, like, they've ruined so many people's lives.
So, and we can do that forever, but I think Charlie out of the main cast.
Yeah, Charlie
is a redeemable person.
Charlie is a person who's gone through so many. Wouldn't it be nice to live in your room with Uncle Jack like you were? No, Mom, I don't want to live with Uncle Jack. I don't.
Show me on the doll.
Oh, no. When he meets, when Jack Kelly meets the other attorney, who is like a professional, put-together,
yeah.
nice person. Why, hello, Jack Kelly. It's very nice to meet you. It's very nice to meet you. I'm Jack Kelly. It's very nice to meet you. It's very nice to meet you. He just keeps it.
But yeah, that's a. I think that was a good dive into some tropes we like.
Oh, absolutely.
Because you know, not all tropes have to be bad.
No. There's some very.
And it's still fun to see when they break like certain tropes. So
absolutely.
So the other thing I wanted to get into was setting. Just because I was talking to someone mm-hmm. about this, and I thought it'd be fun. Some of your favorite kinds of settings, interesting settings that.
Honestly, I think that a setting that is underutilized and is very interesting to mm-hmm. me is the Pacific Southwest.
Okay.
The Southwest. Just that kind of Arizona, Tucson, or New Mexico kind mm-hmm. of area. I think that there's a lot of good material that can be drawn out of there.
Mm-hmm.
And the only series or things... The only things I can think of that utilize that space were Breaking Bad.
Yeah.
And Welcome to Night Vale, which is not visual, so you
yeah.
only kind of get descriptions of spaces. I mean, not to...
But the setting's still there.
The setting's
and
still
it's,
there.
I think, important to, like, the show. So.
And I think that... I don't know. I think that people don't know what to do with that setting for some
yeah.
reason, but I think that
it's a weird setting. It's essentially deserts that's highly, like, occupied.
Yeah. But, yeah, it is.
It's always weird... yeah, people don't know how to make it use it. Because it's still like, yeah, people live here, but stuff's kind of far away
mm-hmm.
from each other. There's long stretches of road that just aren't surrounded by anything, but you need to use them.
And also I think that it undermines most people's concept of what a desert should be.
Yeah.
In that, you know, people think of deserts and they think of arid, places where life just doesn't exist.
Yeah,
the desert,
Lawrence of Arabia style,
exactly,
like, levels. Yeah.
The Saudi Arabian desert. Mm-hmm. But this does, like, there's a lot of deserts that are full of life.
Yeah.
Cacti and owls and lizards and tarantulas and
snakes and, yeah, vulture. Yeah.
They're not particularly friendly life.
No.
They are life that is as hostile as the environment
yeah.
they are in. But, yeah, I think that as a setting is a place that is worth investing in.
Mm-hmm.
And I, too, am guilty of that. I struggle to think of... Because, I mean, I think setting is related to character, is related to narrative.
Mm-hmm.
It all needs to
yeah.
work together cohesively. And so you have to think of, you know, when you're talking about that setting, you are then inherently thinking of a narrative or characters that call to mind the kinds of ideas that come naturally with that setting.
Yeah.
So, like, what I would say is
that's why everyone does New York and, like, big cities so often.
Yeah.
Is because one, you can just do whatever the fuck you want, because, like, big cities are kind of just a hodgepodge
exactly
of everything. But two, you can have, like, progressive characters in there,
mm-hmm.
Which you can feel good about as a writer, like, putting in there.
Exactly. And then the other places are the forest, the coast, or the plains. I've seen lots of stories.
There's so many in the forest.
Dude. So many in the forest.
Well, because the forest is so, like, this just... It's a mystery. Like, it's super scary. Have you ever been in a forest at night? It's terrifying.
It is.
You can't see that well ahead of you, and there's noises at all the fucking time. So, like, yeah, no, it's a good, like, horror setting.
It is an excellent horror setting. I mean, it's an excellent mystery setting. Mm-hmm. It has, again, see, but that's the thing, is people have tapped into...
Yeah.
This is what this environment influences on the narrative and the characters.
It's starting to become, like, environments... If I picked a forest as an environment, like, or a very kind of foresty area, it has to be, the story, I guess, is going to be, like, Twin Peaks-y, where the characters are weird, or it's going to be a mystery, or it's going to be a supernatural thing, or it's going to be a horror.
Or if you have the coast, I mean, also, that depends what coast you're doing. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can go into the, you know, shame on me for forgetting the word, semiotics, symbology, the symbolism of... You have the West Coast, and that represents the West and expansion. And you look at the ocean, and it's like, oh, there's all the future of the things out there on the sea.
Yeah, we'll get Japan one day.
And then you have the East Coast, and it's like, oh, well, there's all the places we've been and the infinite history of humanity and things like
that. Yeah.
This is purely an American-centric thing, but whatever. So, but...
That's true. Like, a lot of the settings we're talking like, we're talking about right now is very American-centric.
These are very American... We can try and delve out.
It's what we know, okay? Shut up.
But, I mean, I guess that would also apply technically to Mexico and Canada in the similar ways that those countries' histories are. Like, East Coast is the past.
Well, if it's done in Mexico...
future.
If the settings in Mexico, it's gonna be in the slums and, like...
It's gonna be a rough time.
Yeah, it's gonna be a rough time. Never mind the, like, Mexico City or any of the artistic capitals there.
I mean, there's so much else going on. But,
or Baja, which is just a big fishing, like, area.
Yeah, so. I mean, again, so you've just pointed out excellent places that aren't utilized very much at all.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and Mexico City is, as I understand it now, a big arts...
Oh, it's district. Huge art thing. Like, I just did a project for a class where I was looking into stuff from Mexico City.
Oh, wow. Yeah. There's some great... just as a side note for anyone out there, there's a great museum at the ELAC, the East LA Community College.
Okay.
It's the Vincent Price Art Museum.
Okay.
Vincent Price's personal collection of Azteca and Mayan, like, art.
Oh, that's cool.
And it's beautiful, ancient stuff. You can go there, and I think it's free to get in.
Nice.
So,
maybe I'll check that out.
Yeah, check that out. But yes, back to the point we were making. I think that people, if they want to go for Pacific South, the Southwest, or if they want to go for industrial or metropolis, Mexico, or those two places, at least, that aren't developed broadly narratively, I think. You need to think about what is it that your environment is saying, and then develop a story out of that. If you're looking for something like that.
Oh, the environment has to be... Like, it doesn't necessarily have to be a character itself.
No.
But at the very least, it has to have influence on your characters, or, like, the plot itself.
Exactly. I mean, like, it's really a case of... Certain stories only work in certain locations, and it doesn't make sense other places. I mean, you could think of... off the top of my head... So, you have a film like Mulholland Drive.
Okay.
Have you ever seen that movie?
I've seen bits and pieces of it. I know it's, like, the most disconnected, like, of Lynch's stuff. And it was his last movie, right?
It's his second to last. The last one was... Inland Empire was the last one.
Really? Okay.
So he's got a theme. But if you moved Mulholland Drive to Tucson, the entire kind of crux of meaning changes.
Mm-hmm.
Because so much of the film was based on celebrity and what it means to be a famous person and things like that.
Yeah, it
and
has
so
to be set in Hollywood.
It's tied to Hollywood and LA and that whole thing. So, like, when you think about... I keep saying Tucson, so let's say Tucson.
Sure.
You have to think about...
Did you just go there recently or something, or did you have this obsession?
I actually had a friend who just sent me a painting from Tucson.
Okay.
So let's say you really like turquoise, and you're going to Tucson.
Turquoise is cool.
Turquoise is very...
Shut up, it's great.
You have to think about, like, what is this location saying?
Mm-hmm.
What is the... I mean, the shorthand is, what is the baggage that's tied to it?
Yeah.
Forest, the baggage tied to it is, there's a lot of things in here that could murder me at any point.
It's very kind of primal, like the forest idea.
So. Exactly, exactly. So you have to think about, I mean, so the answer to the desert, it would be, in my opinion, is hardenedness. Mm-hmm. It actually, you know what, it would be actually a really good place to set a noir, probably.
I think it would. Very just kind of like, people tend to be more independent in like those kind of areas. Because you kind of have to be. Like,
you kinda have to be.
You're essentially on the middle of nowhere except for that little community you live in. You have to have very hardened characters.
And I mean, that reflects the environment. It is a extreme environment that breeds a hard person. Mm-hmm. A hard life out of... I mean, the only things that survive are things that either eat the faces of other things or literally burrow inside of thorn trees called cactuses.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I mean, that's one solution we could talk about for that location.
No worries. I wasn't even going for that. It's just, what locations do you like? but no, that's a good, just underutilized stuff.
Yeah.
It's actually funny you were mentioning the Aztec thing, because I was talking to someone about that.
Oh, cool.
And we were talking about, like, how Aztec and Mayan, like, not... It could be mythology, but kind of, like, just aesthetic is not utilized too often.
No,
even though it's pretty fucking badass and, like, can be used. Like, the Aztecs alone... I think I've mentioned on the very first fucking episode of this podcast where I love the idea that sports are life and death and need to be used in order to keep the world turning. otherwise we all die. and I love that idea, the very warrior heavy society. And one of the games I was talking to him about that did use an Aztec, actually it's probably more Mayan, aesthetic recently is Severed, done by Drinkbox Games. Mm. Probably famous for, most famous for, oh my god, your wrestler is a Metroidvania. More Metroid than Vania. Oh my god, that's gonna kill me because it's a very obvious name and like...
Just dub it back in when you're edited.
Sure. and that game uses a mix of Aztec and almost Lovecraftian.
Oh, wow.
And it's really cool. Like, the setting is really awesome. And like, the monsters you fight are pretty... Yeah, they're pretty... out there, but still obviously have Mexican influence on it, and you explore like these temples that are very Mayan-y. It's just a really cool setting that I thought was... So if you want to check out kind of like that aesthetic I'm talking about, check out Severed for anyone.
What platform is that on?
That one's on the Vita.
Vita.
Because it uses the touchscreen.
Okay.
Really well. And it's actually one of the better games on the Vita, I think. It's a first-person dungeon crawler with a lot of the problems I have with those kinds of games gone, because it's very tight. Like, it's a very short game. In fact, I 100% in, like, two settings.
Oh, wow.
Two settings or something like that. Yeah, just real good. And then trying to think of other...
Other good mythologies that I think haven't been tapped into, if we're talking about mythologies that are underutilized. I mean, for one, we could just go back to what we were talking about at the beginning, Native American mythology.
Mm-hmm.
Very.
Although I think it's starting to get an uprising now. Like,
it might be having a conflict.
With some stuff we like Tanis and...
Oh yeah, Tanis is definitely dipping its toes into that. And also, you know what? Not to drag the conversation back entirely on tropes,
sure.
But when you look at the latest Pokemon games that have been coming out, and also the latest Disney film, there's also an interest in indigenous people from Polynesian culture as well.
Polynesian, okay.
Being...
Yeah, and that one's definitely underutilized. It's always been kind of cool, though. Like,
it's always been super cool.
And, well, Lilo and Stitch
kind of... It kind of touched on it.
And, well, it I wouldn't say it touched the mythology thing. I think it just touched that setting really well.
A little bit of the culture and the setting, definitely.
Yeah. Like, I like that the two characters, like the adult characters, the older sister, who I'm forgetting the name, and the surfer guy, both work at resorts because it's a tourist-heavy area and... Mm-hmm. A lot of people's jobs come from, like, resorts that are just there.
Mm-hmm. And I think one of the greatest losses to the canon of Disney films was, there's a cut scene that they did an animatic for that I really like. They did the voiceovers to.
Okay.
It was Lilo goes to the beach, and it is just barraged by the whites. Tourists who have come in, and she does something or other that sets off like one of the alarm posts and just screams, "Tsunami's gonna come, everyone fucking run!" And then just panics these people. And I'm like, why would you cut that? That's one of the most endearing things I've seen a child do.
But yeah, that's definitely a mythology that can be tangible on. Like, it's a pretty cool one, too.
It's a pretty rich one, and it has... Of course, it has its culturally, you could look at it. I don't know about necessarily Hawaiian mythology specifically, but like certainly in Polynesian culture, there's this interesting blending where you can kind of see culture from far Eastern Asia when those ancient ancestors, wherever they were, crossed that Bering Strait, and because there's connections and overlapping in at least I know Shintoism to certain Native American cultures in the Southwest. Oh my god, it's full circle! But because, I don't know if I ever talked about it to you, I doubt I did on the podcast, but there was a really famous story about the Native Americans who lived in those like cliff dwellings. You know the ones I mean?
Where? In the Southwest?
In the Southwest.
Okay, yeah.
Like, they carved cities out of the rock face.
Because it was cooler and the desert's a hell of a place to live.
It's a hellish place. Yeah. And it turns out that, like, their language structure is almost the same as Japanese.
I didn't know that.
The word for uncle and grandfather are the exact same words.
Huh.
And that their creation mythology is more or less verbatim the Shintoist creation mythology.
Interesting. Okay.
And so there was like this heavy implication that no one for some reason ever followed up on, but, or maybe I didn't. Maybe
maybe.
It's probably me. But
for all we know, a big development was made just like yesterday.
but the idea that this is like a, like, for anthropologists studying this is like, oh my god, this is culture. We're watching it move across the landmass here. So, I mean, that's just bringing everything back into one neat bow, really. That's the other thing I could recommend is Haitian or like voodoo mythology. I think.
Oh, you don't know what you're messing with, child.
Have you seen?
That was really racing.
That was really racist. I talked past it to ignore. Yeah. But
no, I acknowledge it. That was bad. What I did was the wrong thing.
Have you seen Serpent and the Rainbow? It's
a West Raven. No.
Oh, it's wonderful. It has the dad from Casper is how I remember his name. Bill Pullman,
maybe? Wait, that's how you remember
that's
Bill
how
Pullman?
I remember Bill Pullman.
Not Independence Day? You don't view him as the greatest president ever like I do?
He also saved us. I just remember him being really sad about his wife.
okay.
So Bill Pullman goes to...
That's President Bill Pullman.
President Pullman. Goes to Haiti and he basically gets voodooed real hard and he like drowns, he like gets buried in a grave and turned into like
the voodoo zombie
do the voodoo zombie thing where he's like stupefied and he like is barely breathing and and then he like comes out and he's got paint on his face and he's just like I'm quoting and no, it's an amazing movie.
Okay.
But I think that, and not even to, I don't mean this to, again, I feel like I sound judgy. Mm-hmm. Not to judge, but I think that there's other things in voodoo that are interesting to explore beyond, like, fucking up white people with movies. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, there's because voodoo has this weird thing where it's like quasi-Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because it's a blend of West African beliefs and...
Well, the whole idea behind the voodoo zombie was the fear that a lot of Haitians who were being turned into slaves would come back from the dead and have to keep being a slave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
That this is forever.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where that whole thing stems. Yeah, so it is a good, like, blending of culture. Not a good one.
Well,
but
not
it,
the slavery part,
but it's interesting.
It's an interesting blending of cultures. And the idea that, like, there's so many, like... So, because they're... Again, because of the Catholicism thing, they're technically not, in quotes, gods.
Yeah.
But there's spirits who are, for some reason, assigned to be in charge of things.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like a god would.
Yeah.
That are in voodoo mythology that's really interesting. There's, like, 7 death gods alone.
Awesome.
For one belief system, and that's amazing.
Is it just, like, different kinds of death, too?
Yeah, like... there's one... The 7th is, like, in charge of all of the death, and then there's, like, child
so the manager.
Death. Yes, there's the assistant sales representative.
Yeah.
Quality assurance.
Yes.
And then they have all these different deities that, again, sorry, people who practice voodoo,
yeah.
I'm using air quotes, you can't see, spirits who influence these things. And, I mean, I think that they're deeply interesting. They're as interesting as, like, Thor or Ra, or, you know.
As much as I am in love with Viking mythology, it has been kind of played out.
It's been worn out a little bit.
Yeah. And my problem is they don't go too in depth with it.
No, yeah.
It's very much just Thor, Loki, and Odin
mm-hmm.
type deal. We never get to talk about Fenrir, the wolf who literally eats the world.
Frigga.
Frigga. Yeah. The World Tree,
which
is not just us. Well, they kind of touch upon it in Thor 2, but no one remembers Thor 2.
No one remembers Thor 2.
For good reason. And like,
That's fair.
God, I wish Thor 2 was better. Because I would love if we got more into, like, Viking mythology,
I mean,
the crazier shit.
Yeah, the weird shit about, a giant serpent that
eats the world tree. Nidhogg.
Or how Loki had sex with a horse that one time
yeah.
and made a magic
horse. I love that story. I love
it. It's a beautiful
it's
story.
It's my favorite. Like, it's my favorite how a god got a thing. Like, story.
He turned into a horse and fucked a horse.
No, didn't he get fucked by a horse?
He got fucked
then,
by, he turned into a
and
man,
then
yeah.
birthed it.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes.
He was the, he, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I'm going to make this quick so we don't have to linger on it,
sure.
but there is a weird thing in, Nordic mythologies
mm-hmm.
about Loki and Odin, at least, that I know about, that, because there's always been kind of, in a lot of pagan religions, that
yeah.
women are somehow more inherently magical,
uh-huh.
probably because they push out living
babies.
People.
Yeah.
So that there was this...
I mean, I can't do that.
I can't do that.
I've tried. It's hard.
I'm gonna keep going.
I had the biggest BM once, and I thought that would, like, constitute it.
It weighs over 12 curics.
It wasn't alive.
It's not a bonnet.
It was definitely something.
But, like, there's this because of that, it then became understood among people who wanted to do magic
mm-hmm.
that if you want to be really powerful in magic, you have to be a penetrated partner.
Uh-huh.
That somehow by taking a dick, you get you get magic. You get magic.
I didn't know that aspect. Okay.
So that's why in the mythology, both Loki and Thor are passive partners
yeah.
occasionally, and that makes them more powerful sorcerers. So, I don't know what you want to do with that information, anyone, but...
Well, I was just thinking, because we're talking about how it's not kind of, like, gone into depth. I just thought of a game that
yeah.
goes pretty in-depth with Viking mythology, or at least explores a whole different thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's a game called The Banner Saga, which I do love. Check it out. The art style is actually really cool. It's kind of like an old Disney movie. Or at least that's what it kind of reminds me of.
Mm-hmm.
I want to remember what the name... Because it's not Ice Giants. They look closer to like...
Giants.
No, they look closer like golems or... You know those big giants in Atlantis, the movie?
Yes, yes.
Okay,
the
they look like
things?
Those.
Okay.
And those are the bad guys.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, and that's like a really cool experience. You know, like, I doubt we'll ever get a story on, like, Baldur and, like, Hod.
We might not have to wait that long for a story on Boulder. Wink, wink. I mean, I can't say who it is because that spoils the story, yeah. But check it out, people. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. I have
the good authority. Yeah. I'm excited because I like the whole brother betrayal and going to hell thing.
I mean, that's their whole dichotomy.
To fix it. But true story, it's not the first story I wrote, but the first big story I think I wrote. Yeah. Uh-huh. Is based on that too, like on that relationship.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't know if you remember that high school story I gave you, Fate of Norns.
I remember that one.
I even gave their last names based on it.
I think that went in the magazine, didn't it?
It did go in the magazine.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, yeah. I remember that.
Okay, yeah, that one was based on that whole thing. So cool. Yeah. So, yeah, going back to settings, just because there are some settings I do want to mention that I fucking love and adore.
Mm-hmm.
One that's been talked about recently on the Best Friend cast, which, as you can tell, I listen to a lot, is the idea of an apocalypse. Mm-hmm. But specifically, you're in that moment where it's happening, but you're not, but people aren't fully aware that's happening. So you see this mostly with zombie apocalypses, right? Because what you get is you either get right before or as everything is as shit's hitting the fan,
mm-hmm.
or you get way after where you get your Walking Dead and stuff.
I woke up from a coma.
Yes. Two books that come to mind, mm-hmm. Right now. World War Z does this incredibly well, mm-hmm. where stuff's kind of just happening, like diseases and, hey, there's like rumors on the internet that people are coming alive, but no one's like doing anything. Does it really fucking well, like just this slow progression into it.
Mm-hmm.
This slowly to the point where, yeah, people didn't buy into it until it was in their fucking backyard.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
Like, I love that. I love this idea that, yeah, it's kind of just, yeah, mm-hmm. we're not sure if anything's happening. The other one is a manga called I'm Not a Hero.
Oh,
yeah. And that one's even slower in its like reveal to it.
Uh-huh.
And it's cool that what that manga does really well is it does explore kind of like Japanese social norms and kind of just how they handle it.
Okay.
And how bad it would be for an apocalypse.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Or how it would lead to some pretty messed up stuff.
Mm.
Like the politeness like gets people killed because you're so polite. Obviously this person's kind of ransack you for stuff and all that.
Right.
And actually, World War Z in the book has a moment like that where Neat or Hikikomori, however you want to say it, is a character in there and is, yeah, basically family leaves him. And, like, because he's so hung up in his room, you know, and, like, people forget he exists.
Mm-hmm.
And until, like, the zombies are in his building and stuff. Yeah. Oh, God. I love that. I love this slow, like, kind of just shit hasn't hit the fan yet.
Mm-hmm.
But there's stuff happening, and, you know, the characters aren't aware of it. So let me try. What was the other saying? How do I define this? So I was thinking of, like, sci-fi saying future.
Oh,
saying.
Sure.
Because a lot of people for the future want, like, stuff's kind of sleek,
mm-hmm.
you know, thing. And I'm, like, always been kind of drawn to the cyberpunk thing,
mm-hmm.
where, yeah, it's the future, but we haven't figured out, like, everything, all the kinks yet.
Yeah.
And it's still kind of very machine heavy,
mm-hmm.
and kind of ugly looking when you think about it. Like, I love the Arcadia setting.
Yeah,
just that whole fucking thing. I'm not gonna go too into that because that's more of an aesthetic type deal that I like.
Sure.
One that I do find interesting though for a setting is the future where it's so far ahead that an apocalypse happened, but that was like thousands of years ago.
We've already done everything.
And you have remnants of, like, the past.
Sure.
One of my favorite settings in any game is in SMT4.
Okay.
Where you start off in that game is you're kind of just like a samurai. And you fight a monster, and yeah, like, that's kind of weird. There's demons and stuff in there. Then you pass your test, and you go into it, and it still kind of looks like medieval and stuff like that. And then you get a fucking techno gauntlet that's, like, has like digital display and everything, and a fucking AI that helps you, and it contains demons that you can help summon. And it's such a like jarring detail in there. And then you find, and I don't want to go into too much about this, because that setting honestly is one of the coolest fucking settings in there. And what makes it so cool is just a slow reveal of what everything is. Just that whole thing of like, yeah, we're in the future to a point where stuff has kind of gone back to medieval stuff, but we still have remnants of this technology and we still kind of use it.
Yeah.
And we can chalk it up to magic because it was so advanced at that time that we don't understand how stuff works. I love that. And I don't think it's used that too often because it's such a scary and hard thing to do. Like, because you have to use a kind of like very alien kind of perspective where, yeah, they're going to call it something wrong. It's obviously this thing, but how often do you do that to a point where it's like, oh, just call it the fucking thing already?
Yeah, exactly.
Or I like seeing the idea of a tank being turned into a statue. Like, I was trying to work that into a story at one point. Just these remnants where our reality becomes a myth. That whole thing.
I mean, just a brief, like, aside to that, and then I have another thought, but there's a film from the 80s called The Gods Must Be Crazy.
Okay.
You know that movie?
No.
So The Gods Must Be Crazy is it's actually a pretty good movie from what I remember, but it has in like tribal African people and then kind of like I can't remember, they were like political dissidents of some kind.
Okay.
Who were trying to rob banks in the city of Africa, and so like it's all kinds of different parts of, I think it was filmed in Nigeria.
Okay.
But the inciting incident is these tribal people live so secluded from the modern world that they're still living in, you know, the ancient ways in 1980s Africa.
Yeah.
And then a biplane flies by, and like the narrator,
I think I have heard of this.
Oh, yeah. And the narrator explains, like, oh, occasionally the gods send giant birds through the sky. We don't ever look at them.
Yeah.
Such, such and such. And at one point, someone's drinking a Coke, and he throws a Coke bottle out the window, and it falls to the in the middle of the village, and they're like, oh my god, the gods gave us a magic crystal! And they use it to, like, mash dough, and, like, they use it as a practical tool,
because
that's, of course, what you do.
Yeah.
And then it becomes a burden for the community, because they realize, oh, there's only one of them, and we live in a society where no one owns, like, private property. Like, everyone shares something, and it's causing people to hate each other. This is a curse from the guy. And then so they send the chief of the village to walk to the edge of the world, which is where the grass stops growing. And then they just throw the bottle. And then it all ties into, oh, no, it turns out the minute he threw that bottle, it actually hit this car, and it caused this chain of events that stopped these political dissidents with guns and things like this.
Yeah.
So, I mean, to that, I like that.
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
It reminds me of a conversation I was having with Nick, where we were watching Drifters. I don't know if you got to check it out. That was the show I called History of the Dream Fight. Which, by the way, it's been a while since me and Nick have watched an anime where we're just talking about the whole, what they can do with it, because it's such an interesting idea. There's this thing that happens where they're trying to make guns in the show for a thing, and they want to make them, and they have them. They have, like, a different, they have a specific type of musket in there, and they have a Gatling gun and, like, a revolver, and they're like, hey, can your people figure out how to do this? And essentially what it boils down to is that technology is so far fucking advanced, even though we have it, and we have all the parts for it, we don't know what to fucking do and, like, how to make it.
That's
crazy. Like, because everyone assumes if you give a piece of technology to someone, you know, the whole Stanley Kubrick, like, space Nazi thing, of course they're going to advance and learn how to use it. Or no one ever suggests, no, the boat is so fucking big that we don't know. We don't fucking know how this would work.
I can't even begin to imagine how that works.
Yeah, like it's always weird in alien movies or invasion where they just get the technology and they go, oh, but we obviously made this thing, and like,
where, oh, like what's his name? Like in Independence Day when they use Macintosh programming.
Yeah. To hack. Okay. Well, that's like a whole different. That's a whole different problem.
Oh, okay.
like, I can buy into the sequel to Independence Day. I haven't seen it, but I know how they got the specific kinds of jets for there was the technology in there. Okay. And I can buy that they were able to reverse engineer it because it didn't seem too far ahead. Okay. But I'm talking, like, centuries or, like,
right.
stuff where we don't even know what the how to use the raw material in this manner. We don't know how to temper steel in that kind of way. I love that. I love this idea of just dropping it in. And it's so hard that you're like, what the fuck? What are you supposed to do? And just the whole mashing with the thing, like, kind of reminded me of that.
Oh, yeah.
So another thing that goes off of the whole future thing is I'm in love with the idea of cycles for a thing. And I think a thing that uses this really well is Dark Souls, okay. where each game is, yes, it's in the same universe, and yes, it's the same mythology, but it's like hundreds, if not thousands of years ahead, and yet we're still experiencing the same kind of shit.
Well, because, like, it never goes past the middle age, like the dark ages of
yeah.
things.
Or if it does, it just comes back around. Like, okay. This world is fucked no matter what. Mm-hmm. And really what you're doing is just deciding how fucked it's going to be, mm-hmm. like, in the end. And it all reverts back to this. Like, there's no good way to go about it. And this is where you have stuff that I think is kind of cool where some of the names start getting, they're not changed, but they're, like, they're not completely different, but they're changed just slightly, mm-hmm. because it's been so long that, yeah, we just kept saying it this way.
Oh, uh-huh.
So now the character is blankety instead of blank.
Right.
And I always dig that. I love just seeing it progress into that kind of manner.
No, I know what
just you're like about. How heavy influence we have on mythos. Mm-hmm. Essentially, we do create it. With a very radical idea.
I mean, I've definitely heard a lot of talk about Dark Souls just fundamentally as being, like, I mean, there's lots of discussions about, like, what does it mean, though?
Yeah.
Like, what is it about, like, I know that I've heard a lot of conversations about it being, this is the only thing I've, because I've not personally played it myself,
mm-hmm.
That it's a deeply Freudian experience.
Really? Okay. How's
that? I don't know. Tell me how you think.
I don't know. Other than there's a boss called the Penetrator. So,
okay. Yeah. That was a part of it. But, like, also that you when you start the game, you mm-hmm. come out of a place that's like a cavern or like a little hutch kind of thing. Is that right?
Well, in the first one, you're in jail.
Okay.
And you get out of jail.
Okay.
Second one, yeah, that's a, no, it's not a hutch. What it's implied.
It's like a cavern or a cave?
No, it's a giant, it's actually a big open area where you're kind of in this, like, Roman style, like, it's not a plateau and it's not, it's kind of just a circle, like a kind of platform or whatever.
Okay.
In the third one, you come out of a coffin.
Oh, okay.
So maybe, Demon Souls. I'm trying to remember what you come out of in Demon Souls. Demon Souls, you come out of. Maybe it was Hodge. I don't know. I don't remember for Demon Souls. I also want to say it was a jail. Like,
because there's this talk about there being a lot of, like, caves and caverns that you have to go through.
Yeah, you do have to go through a lot of them.
And that there's this weird focus on imagery of, like, Freudian imagery of entering caves, like, that are genital shaped and having,
oh, like, vagina shaped. I can see that for Dark Souls too. I think that cave you come out of is very vagina like.
And having,
I don't know. I feel like that theory is kind of reaching for it. Like,
is it?
Yeah.
Okay. I have no legs to stand on, so yeah. I'll agree with you.
I think it kind of is. I mean, there's definitely the whole idea of birth in there. I wouldn't
and
say
rebirth and keep.
Yeah. Well,
to go
rebirth. Rebirth, like I said, is like the crux of that entire setting. As for Freudian, sex heavy, like, kind of I want to fuck my mom type deal, I don't think so.
I'm so glad that's on camera.
I tried to say it fast enough so no one can single it.
I'm gonna make it my ringtone.
I wouldn't say that. I'm fully on board that it is all rebirth because it's very obvious. And, you know, I could argue you're kind of born into the game and that you make your character and stuff. But that doesn't sit well for me in that jail, in the jail setting.
Right,
DS1.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Unless you can argue that, oh, you come out of a new man when you come out of jail. I don't think so.
Yes, I see.
Because you have to kill a fucking demon when you're coming
like
out.
Like a baby does.
I don't see it.
No, it's
I would
hard.
Have to look into
it's
it.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a lot of stuff. You can go down the rabbit hole and, like, search for days of what stuff means.
I'm sure that's a deep metaphoric hole.
Yeah.
I...
There's a very good playthrough by Plague of Gripes, who is an artist I follow, who is a big DS1
oh, okay.
guy. Cool. Real good artist, too. Where he does, like, yeah, he explores the lore in each episode. My only thing is, like, you have to be really interested in the Dark Souls lore.
Right.
Because those episodes are, like, an hour long.
It's like a deep dive.
Yeah, and there's, like, 40 of them. So you have to dedicate, like, yourself to doing that. Like, even I dropped off after a bit because I was like, I don't have time to, like, do this anymore.
I have to do other things with
yeah.
my life.
If it came for me where it was, like, I'm just going to kind of do it as a podcast. Which you can in some episodes because he just sits there and, like, tells the story of it. But then there's stuff that's very visual that you have to look at and, like, as you
right.
explain.
Right.
But, yeah, I'm in love with the idea of cycles. I'm in love with the idea that the whole rebirth cycle
mm-hmm.
and that, yeah, it's you're fucked either way. And, like, stuff just keeps going and going.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, just going so far along that stuff from our time becomes just myth.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, Matt, there's a scene in Fury Road where they go, oh, what's that, like, in the sky? Because it's moving, but it's not a shooting star, obviously. Go, it's a satellite. And, like, yeah, what the fuck is that? It's just something, like, we were told from an old age. Or,
right.
No, she says she knew what a satellite was as a kid, so that made me think, like, it was fairly recent. That,
how,
which yeah, I don't buy into it.
How long is the apocalypse supposed to happen?
I
want to
say 100 years.
100
because
years?
I thought about this, like, really hard, like... Because, well, they still need to know how to use the technology.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, there's some people don't know what satellites are and stuff.
Yeah.
There's remnants of parts. Morning Joe apparently is like a deific god. So we had to resort to that thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's got to be a long time. Yeah, maybe it's longer than 100 years. Because I don't think 100 years constitutes that.
Yeah.
But they still know what a show is.
Yes.
And like, because they're like, oh, show. Everyone had a show or something.
Mm-hmm.
That. So they have to know what that is. They have to know basic medicine. Or not even just basic medicine. They need to know how blood transfusion works.
Right, yes.
Because they do it. They don't do it right, but they do it.
They
like,
kind of do it, yeah.
Yeah. And it works in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's always kind of ambiguous, which I kind of dig in the Mad Max world, because then you still can just do crazy shit.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like I mentioned in the last episode how I'm not too into... Like, I like when you explain stuff, but I don't want to have the thing where, okay, I'm going to sit down to you, and I'm going to tell you how magic works in this world, or, like, how, what time period we're in, and why everything is like that. I like to just see it, like, to
right.
kind of imply it.
Let me walk you through the history of the Dragon Ages.
Yeah.
And, okay, so, here's my retort setting
sure.
that I really like, I think, and is underused setting,
okay.
is the past future...
Okay.
It is the future that the past promised us.
Oh, sure. So, like, 1980s
Exactly. I'm more into 1960s future. I love 1960s
future. Oh, okay.
So, it's like, it's the future. There are robots and flying cars and,
yeah.
like, automated
beep
things.
Boop, beep bops.
Exactly.
And, like...
But women still wear, like, those plastic PVC skirts that are all shiny.
Yeah.
And, like, people still have shag carpet and wood
mm-hmm.
panel walls. But also, like...
It's all kind of rounded and
everything's
like,
all kind of like plasticky.
Yeah,
everything's kind of designed by Apple, but also kind of designed by like Martha Stewart.
It's like Jetsons, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, that's basically that. I want the Jetsons.
You
to
want
be
Jetsons?
Big. I want people to live in modernist houses that outlook an infinite abyss.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, that is underutilized. I don't think we've. Because no one ever thinks of the future like that anymore.
No one thinks of the future like that. Because we've gone through this period...
Because we're probably more advanced than that future is.
Oh,
now,
yeah,
so.
We are. Like, there's a legitimately great... A great joke in Harvey Birdman.
Okay.
You remember that? And,
yeah, no, I fucking love Harvey Birdman.
And
by the way, like, I was pretty bummed out when the artist died.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Something
yeah.
Cron. Which sounds really great for me,
loving him, guy.
I just always forgot the name, but I knew he did, like, Aqua Teen Hunger Force. And yes. Space Ghost Coast to Coast. Yeah, he did. So fuck you if you haven't watched Space Ghost Coast to Coast. Go watch it.
It's so funny.
Oh, God.
When Conan...
Don't watch original Space Ghost, because original Space Ghost is boring as hell. Yeah, yeah. Watch Space Ghost Coast to Coast.
When he interviews Conan O'Brien, and Conan O'Brien's only response is, I feel like you're mocking
me. Yeah. But yeah, the Jetsons.
The Jetsons thing. Oh. So they made an appearance on Harvey Birdman.
Okay.
As
attorney at law.
Attorney at law. And they were suing Earth.
Okay.
For not doing anything about global warming.
Yeah.
Because sea levels had gotten so high that they couldn't make their houses go any higher.
Yeah.
and the joke is, we're from the future, the distant year of 2002. And he looks at his calendar and it says 2007.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, it's like that Fly the Conchord song, Robots, where they're like, we're from the future 1998.
Oh, yeah, 1998.
Well, yeah, that one's interesting. The way that setting would have to work nowadays, it would have to be a spoof or like,
oh, absolutely.
A play on thing. I don't think you can have a serious setting in there.
Or you'd have to be like talking about the 60s.
Yeah.
And for some reason you wanted to have a sci-fi element. Those are the two things I could think. But like,
what do you think about near future settings? Stuff like
I just saw a trailer for
oh yeah, what?
The Space Between Us, a teenage romance film.
Okay.
And a near future film.
Yeah.
What do I think about it generally?
Yeah, like Smart House, that old Disney movie, if anyone remembers it.
I remember that was Peggy. Peggy was in that, right?
Yes.
From Married with Children.
Yep, she was. And I was like young and knew who Peggy was. Yeah. From Married.
I like it. I like near future stuff. I think that it's interesting. I think that
A lot of comic books try to do it too.
A lot of
superhero things, like Century City, like from The Flash.
Yeah,
it's kind of like that.
I mean, also most of the comic book universe's mainstream stuff is it's now, but like with better technology.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is actually how I mostly view how people view new near future.
Yeah, exactly.
So
it's basically now, but with slightly better technology. I think that it's good. I like it a lot, but I think that you don't have the same liberties with it that you...
No, yeah, see, that's the kind of thing that puts it down for me. That's why I like the so far future, but, like, everything reverting.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you can do whatever the fuck you want.
You can do whatever you want. Now, when I say that you don't have the same liberties, I actually just mean specifically... I don't even think that it's necessarily like, I think you can do a lot with technology. You have a lot of liberty there. You can do a lot of technology as magic stuff.
Yeah.
Because I think we're at an age where technology is advancing enough that we could have like a, oh yeah, we just invented the weather machine.
Yeah.
You know, that thing.
Well, we're already doing cloud seeding.
My family has been watching Ancient Aliens every
day. I know we were talking about it the other day.
So,
Ian,
yes.
I don't know if you know about the Star Child and that skull and how that's obviously an alien, or how the fuck everyone could build a goddamn pyramid. Like,
how do you explain that? Mexico, Egypt, yeah. China, yeah. All pyramids, all at the same time. Well, why did they do that?
Yeah, Ian, why?
I mean, it was huge chunks of time, but anyway.
No, shut up. How come every culture has a version of a dragon? Somewhere in there.
I mean, dinosaurs were real.
They were put into the earth by aliens.
Oh, okay. I didn't know where you were going.
Yeah, geez, Ian.
I'm sorry.
Wow. You're one of those self-hating Jews, aren't you?
Can I just say, like, legitimately, probably one of the funniest things they did on Arrested Development was meeting Anne's grandparents and having them sit down. And he went on to explain where Anne was. And why? What, I think the line was, and when the Jews buried dinosaur bones in the 40s to confuse people. He had like a time frame. But What was I saying? Oh yeah.
I know. I totally forgot what you were going to go.
The shortcoming of it is that that people aren't. I don't think people are as receptive to anything you have to say about near future because they view it as, oh well, it's just now.
Yeah.
So.
So people kind of have to act like
they kind of tune. They, I think that you have the risk of people tuning you out even more.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example,
oh, I just thought of a show that did the near future thing really well. I don't know. Keep going with yours.
I was going to say unlike that, like you have Star Trek, the original series.
Okay,
and you can have
not near future.
That's not near future. unlike that,
that's the far future that I'm not too big of a fan of. Where it's not. Far, far, like, away. It's just,
distant.
Yeah, it's distant.
But, like, in Star Trek, it was distant enough that people, like, they used it as an excuse to talk about race issues and things like that. Uh-huh. That was one of the big things they did.
Yeah.
Obviously. And I think that if you
half black, half white people.
They're white on the wrong side!
True story. Yeah. I was asked in, like, high school what I thought diversity was.
Uh-huh.
Like, huh? And it was to a friend, and he asked me that, and then I went, oh, you know those half black, half white people in Star Trek? That's what I think. And then he was like, that's not what I was looking for. I was like, yeah, well, that's what you got.
But see, so like people in the 60s, I think it was more palatable, I guess, to watch, like, well, we know what they're talking about, but at least they're not having actual African Americans or Asian people.
Yeah, at least I don't have to look at him.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Yeah. No, so like when you have very near future and you want to talk about something like that, or if you want to talk about, I don't know, global warming or any important,
like, big ticket item, I'm using air quotes to big it.
If you want to talk about serious things like that, the chances are people are going to tune you out because they're like, I don't need to be talked to. I think that it's too near the bone. For people. I think that's the real problem that near future has most of all.
So I think a show that does the near future actually particularly well is Black Mirror.
Yeah.
I don't know if have you watched it?
I have watched it.
Okay, I haven't finished all of it. I think I'm on the last two episodes that are on Netflix. It's really fucking good. Mm-hmm. It really is. And they do a lot of things where it's just kind of things we have nowadays just kind of turned up to 11.
Yeah.
You know, the whole social media episode where you have likes or like how people rate you and stuff and the whole social hierarchy on that. It's not really near future so much as it is what I just said, just kind of the technology taken up to an extreme. But I think the way they're able to get to do the near future setting so well is that they're pretty real. They're just human stories that anyone could relate to. It just happens to have this one thing added in. And you can change up kind of like the different aspects of it. So one of the things is something we have now where you get the personality of a deceased one that you can talk to online. I don't know if you remember that episode.
Yeah.
Where that whole episode is dealing with the loss of a person. But thanks to this technology, we can explore the idea of you'll never get the same person again in the process of grief. They're gone. Even if you have someone who looks like them and has many resembling traits, it's not them. So I think that's one way to do the near future thing well, is you use that as kind of like a twist to kind of play on certain human aspects.
I agree. I think that is a show that does it very well. Mm-hmm. I think that is a show that does it very well. But I know that, like, so like my favorite episode of Black Mirror, I think is amazing. But I think that it has turned a lot of people off because it was so.
This is the first episode?
It's the pig.
Yeah, okay.
The pig.
Really? That's what caught me to watch the rest of the show.
I loved it. But, like, yeah, I think it was too much for some people. But, like,
It gets there, man. It's intense. Don't spoil it because I want people to watch the show.
Really want people to watch. Yeah. So all I will say is, like, in the first act, you listen to it and then you laugh. Because you're like, well, that's fucking dumb.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous. And then the tension of this moment building starts to weigh on you.
Yeah, and it sits there and you're like,
fuck. Is this really going to happen? And then when you get there, when it happens and you're in the room and you see that poor man.
Yeah.
It was a really effective writing because
yeah.
I felt just like the characters. Mm-hmm. I felt like, this is fucking disgusting. This is horrible.
Yeah.
Fuck, this is horrible. Why are you letting this happen? Oh, shit. Okay.
Yeah.
Homework for everyone. Go watch that so we can talk about it in the next
episode.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
I really wanted to talk about that.
That means Nick would have to watch it, and Nick's not going to watch it for, like, months.
Oh, fuck. All right.
Yeah. But
oh, fuck, it's so good.
Too bad he had to be a skeleton.
I'm so sorry. He's been nodding and waving
through
most of this though. Just so you know.
Alright. So what are we doing on time? Anything else? Any other tropes you want to talk about or
I mean I could just talk about one film in general that has a lot of tropes in it and I actually liked it anyway.
Okay.
It's a Disney.
Oh, yeah.
I saw the new Disney film.
Moana?
Moana.
I haven't seen it yet. I am interested in
it. And it, you know what I'm going to say? I really like it. I think it's maybe one of my favorite. It's way. Let me just say this off the top.
If it makes you feel better, Big Hero 6 is.
Oh, Big
up there for me.
Big Hero 6 is amazing.
And it does, yeah. It does a lot of trophy things, and it's not particularly special, but it's really cool. Like,
can I just say from the new run of Disney films, though, Big Hero 6 is clearly better than Frozen? I don't know.
I honestly do not have any affiliation for Frozen.
Like, it's fine, but I wouldn't. It's like a movie that I'd watch if it was on.
And the problem is, I think the audience ruined it for me. Like, I think.
Yeah, the audience.
I think people watched it and loved it, ruined it for
me. Ran it into the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, so Moana is maybe. You know what? You reminded me Big Hero 6 exists and that I have a copy in my house, but.
Big Hero 6 is really cool,
it's
man.
It's a really great movie.
Oh my god. That scene where he goes nuts and then you get the shot of him walking into the. Out of the fog and he looks like a fucking Terminator.
Yes.
Is so awesome.
Amazing.
Like,
plus,
TJ Miller's great. Oh, plus, also, he has my favorite Stan Lee cameo. Because I honestly did almost tear up in that because I thought it was a really beautiful scene.
It's a beautiful scene. It's. I mean. Oh my god. And just all this. I mean, it's. Yeah, it undoes a lot of things that. It does a lot of things that Disney films don't do,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know. I mean, I think Disney has gotten the note of, can you stop doing love interest stories? And they've really.
Also, stop
around.
Killing the family member.
Also, please stop killing the family member.
Yeah.
They haven't done that one yet. Mm-hmm. But, so Moana, I think Moana is actually kind of in a collection of tropes, more or less. And it's just Disney, like, finally nailing its recipe.
Okay.
I think that Disney has finally looked at it and said, okay, these are the things people want on one hand, and these are the things we do because we're Disney.
Mm-hmm.
And they finally found a balance, and it's really good. And it's also great because, again, going back to the fourth wall breaking, they break a lot of... It's not, like, two audience things, but it's breaking narrative... things in the story. There's an actual part where Dwayne the Rock Johnson's character, Maui, says to Moana, he calls her the Chosen One.
Yeah.
Even though that's never been said before, and it's just addressing, like, yeah, this is a Chosen One narrative.
Okay.
This is a Chosen One narrative. We're gonna call it.
Wouldn't you know, this character you're following is the Chosen One.
Exactly.
Which, by the way, was one thing I really didn't like in Harry Potter, just to go back to
that. They called him the Chosen One?
No. Well, one.
Yeah.
Two, that it wasn't Neville. Because reading the book, and I thought for sure it was going to
be
Neville.
Turns out it's Neville.
And I would have liked that.
It would have been a good...
But no, guess what? The character you've been following is the Chosen One.
It's the Chosen One.
Ah.
Fair complaint. Then they have the trope of... they have, again, Maui point out the trope of calling her princess over and over, and her explaining, actually, I'm not a princess, I'm the daughter of a tribal chief, so there's not, like, a kingdom, it's just
collective.
And he then explains, if you're a pretty young girl and you have an animal sidekick, you're immediately a princess. Accurate to their narrative. So, like, that's... And even being able to point those out, it's still a good movie.
Okay.
I'd also say that, I don't know, like, yeah, the whole thing is, it's tropey. It's, grandmother is the only person who knows the true destiny that must be fulfilled. She has to go against the society that wants her to be one thing.
Yeah.
But it's not because they hate her. It's because we love you so much. We don't want to see you get hurt.
I would love to watch a movie where, like, yeah, we just don't want
to. Oh, we just hate you. Yeah. We just hate you.
And look, it's convenient that you're the chosen one because now you can just go away.
Exactly. So, I'm trying to think of any other tropes that it has. I mean, it and then it pretty much nails... It nails tropes that are older than Disney. It goes straight back to, like, mythological, like, those Polynesian tropes, those base myth of just, like, you have to defeat so many monsters before you can be... The Trial of Heroes. Yeah. It does that. So, I mean, it follows that narrative to the letter.
Okay.
But it's still a really good movie. Sure, I still enjoy it.
I think The Trial of Heroes can be done well, especially if the fights are really cool or, like, the monsters are interesting.
The fights are very interesting. Oh, that guy from Flight of the Conchords?
Jermaine?
Jermaine.
Because he's the only one that acts, if I remember correctly.
Jermaine.
So.
Jermaine, he is one of the monsters they fight. And he sings a song.
Oh, that's great. Oh, shut up. Okay, I don't want to hear anymore because I'll know the moment. So, like,
yeah.
That's awesome.
So that's great. He's great in it. I don't know. Yeah, it's a wonderful film. It's very well put together, but I think that it is evidence that there are, back to our original theme, there are tropes that work.
Yeah.
And if you know what you're doing, you can piece them together in a way that is a perfectly, not only satisfactory, but really well done film.
Yeah.
And I mean, ultimately, I think the thing that breaks away and is the most different from any other Disney film is... songwriting, which is all down to, like, Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Okay.
So, like, the guy who wrote Hamilton wrote all the music for it.
I didn't know that. That's
so
cool.
Yeah. The songs are really good, and that's really where it's very different. The music is... Because Disney does have that...
Is it rap?
It's not rap. Okay. It's poppy, if anything. It's
very... Okay, that's what I expected.
Yeah. But it's very different from... Because usually Disney...
I would love if we have Disney princesses rapping.
I would really.
I want, like, gangster rap, too.
Just
I want
hard.
DMX. Like.
Just what? I'm going to say, I know I made this joke already, but I want a princess to drop. Stop dropping, open up chocolate. I
just want a character to come out and start barking like DMX. Like, where my dogs at? And then he comes out and he goes, where my buddy? Ja Rule. Tim Tam. I'm out here.
Just... I want a princess to come out and not know how to use a computer. I just want to... so yeah, it's a good movie.
Yeah.
I'd recommend go out and see it. But
I do. I want to check it out. It's one of those things I'm doing where I'm just going to wait a weekend or two. That way I can go watch it with the small theater. Because if anyone who knows me knows, I hate going to theaters just because of crowds.
Yeah, it's the worst.
It really is.
I made the worst decision, just briefly, this is barely a story, but I made the worst decision when I thought, oh, that new Wizard of Oz movie might not be bad. I don't know if you remember when that came out. It was a while ago.
Wow, it must have been really good if I don't remember it. Like...
Oh, it was really bad.
Was it?
It was a really good time. James Franco bummed me out a second time.
Oh, he was in it. Oh, I think I do know.
Yeah.
Okay. I only remember one shot from the trailer, though, so...
And I had waited, like, 2 weeks to go see it, and I was like, oh, if I don't go soon, it's probably gonna be cold. And so I went, and I picked fucking worst... I not only was the movie bad, but I picked the worst night. I went on a night when there was just a sea of children. And I'm a lone adult just in this film. Oh, and that's... Nothing's more upsetting than just being the only adult... By yourself?
Yeah.
But my justification is it was a shitty movie, so I left.
Makes you feel better. When I saw the Lego movie, I saw it with Nick and, like, a friend of ours. And we were probably the only ones who weren't parents there. And, yeah, honestly, that girl was fine. I just remember laughing really hard at the scene where Morgan Freeman's character... comes down on, like, fish string.
Oh, he's the ghost.
And
that
was my favorite. And I was laughing so hard the first time I saw it. And I'm, like, the only one laughing with, like, my brother. And to the point where I'm like, oh, I'm the only one. Whatever. This joke's great. He's on fishing wire.
You're all wrong.
Yeah. It's not, see, Ian, it's not me that's wrong. It's the children.
Wait, it can't be me. It's the
children. It's the children.
It's literally, oh my God. My goal is to work in more Simpsons quotes in my daily
life. Yeah. That's what I need. Oh my God. Yeah, Simpsons Marathon was going on over the weekend, so I was watching that. Fuck, what was the quote that I remembered that killed me that I hadn't heard in a while? Fuck me, yeah, I'm not going to try to remember that and waste time.
Why do I have 3 kids and no money when I could have no kids and 3 money? That's one of my favorite lines.
Scare! What's going on in there? The Aurora Borealis.
The Aurora Borealis?
At this time of day, at this time of this part of the country, this part of the world, all localized within your kitchen.
That's right.
Can I see it?
No.
I fucking love. Oh my God. But yeah, so. Yeah, I guess we'll start wrapping it up. Sure, right. Why not? What are you looking forward to coming out?
I'm looking forward to. You know what? I mentioned it last time, but just as a one off. A series of unfortunate events. I read the books when I was a kid, and the series is going to come out as a show on Netflix.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I'm very excited about. Oh, you know what? It's already come out, but I haven't gotten a chance to see it. Is Brad Pitt is in a World War II thriller?
Oh yes, with what's her name? That's in every Christopher Nolan movie.
Yes, the French woman who's always evil.
Yeah,
that's how I remember.
Is she like married to Nolan or something? Because
I think he's just in his all. Okay. Yeah, but it looks really interesting. It looks like a classic.
Yeah, like, I like her.
This golden age Hollywood movie. Actually, uh-huh. Yeah, I'm very interested in that. What about yourself?
Me, FF15 came out 2 days ago now, as of this recording. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, technically yesterday, but it came out like 9 p.m. for those who ordered it. I haven't gotten a chance to play it, just because of homework and stuff, but I am going to be recording a video for my YouTube channel on it. Look forward to that. Anyone who wants to go check out Matt and Chris Play All Night, it's where I play video games and stuff with Matt and Yes, and we do it all night. And, yeah, it's kind of the big one right now I'm looking forward to. I kind of cleaned up on some other stuff that I was reading. There was one thing I wanted to do. I probably have to watch the FF15 movie at some point. So I heard it's better than Advent Children, but I really didn't like Advent
Children. So it's a low bar to clear.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, man. I've met people who like it, and always my first question to them goes, so what was it about? Because I don't know. What do you think it was about?
What do you think it meant?
And then they'll like, and then they always have a hard time struggling.
Well.
And then I remember the antithesis of that like meeting was once in my freshman year of college, where I have a friend who was like, you know, I liked having a children's show. It was great. And then me and another friend both asked him that question. He couldn't know. And then next time we hang out, he comes back and goes, so I looked up the story to Advent Children, and he starts telling it off of like the Wikipedia page or whatever. Oh, and we go, and then we look and we go, man, if you have to look that up and like read it to us like that, it's not a good sign. It's not a good sign. And he goes, well, the action scenes are cool. And I go, one of them's cool, and that's like the Tifa fight, because the other are just weird, dumb air battles that kind of don't work. Mm-hmm. He's like, well, and I'm like, oh, what about that time Vincent came out? He's just a cape flowing around and bullets are coming out. It's like, what's him going and swirling so fast? He's like, no, it's not. The cape's going really fucking slow, but it just happens to make him disappear, except for bullets that come out of the fucking cape. And that made me think his power now is he can launch a cape that has guns in it.
Like, he has a gun cape, yeah.
He's like, well, but it's cool. And I'm like, whatever. And so maybe I'll watch it. I know Aaron Paul's in the FF15.
Okay, well that's good actually.
That's fine, I guess. I like him, but I'm still like, it's an FF movie. Like,
you know what? You have just reminded me one thing. I'm going to do. Last week I finished watching the first season of Better Call Saul.
Fuck! I still have to get on.
It's great.
I still have to get on. That first episode's strong. Oh. And there's no reason that I saw, like, I should have stopped.
No reason not to.
Because I really want to get back and watch it.
Not a spoiler. He manages a Cinnabon. Darkest timeline.
Oh, that reminds me. One of my new favorite phrases now is, you know, people say, like, precious snowflake is because his character's other. Now it's precious Cinnabon. Cinnamon bun.
Cinnamon bun.
And I somehow like that way more.
It's flavorful.
Yeah. Because they're a precious cinnamon bun that must be protected, and I have to make sure they keep smiling. I'm like that. So speaking of anime, I guess, I'm looking forward to more Flip Flappers. I'm really in there. I really am. The last episode was another thing I really liked that was explored. And I'm so glad it turned out a certain way as opposed to a way that I could have thought they may have done.
This is so helpful.
I'm just gonna say two words: super robot. Like, and there we go. So like, and it's awesome. It's great. Oh, they get the song right and everything.
Well, that's good.
What else? More Drifters, because that's becoming more and more interesting. Mm-hmm. Although I want to get to a point where they reveal that the villain's Jesus, as I explained my theory was.
Sure.
I'm gonna be really mad if it's not Jesus, or if it's not Jesus, it better be Moses.
One of the two.
Yeah, one of the
saviors. Better be a Jew.
I think, yeah, that's it for me. Oh, sorry, I didn't mention when I'm watching doing it. You have time for me to talk about this.
Yeah.
I started watching Terrace House.
Oh, how is
on
it?
On Netflix.
How is it?
Ian, when I look at you, you tell me a lot of things. You talk a lot.
Yeah.
But every time you speak, there's nothing for me to hold on to. And your dream is unclear, Ian.
What?
Your dream is oh my god, Terry's house is great. It's like, you'll get to that scene.
Okay.
Because I started saying it now, your dream is unclear. Okay. And part of me wants to get it tattooed onto my back.
Oh my god. Okay.
So how long do you think, when people start dating in this, how long do you think they even get to the first kiss?
Oh, in a normal dating situation?
Sure.
Somewhere between second to third date.
How long do you think it's been taking Terrace House?
Is it episode one? Is it episode one? Is it episode two?
I haven't even gone there. I'm on episode 9 or like 10.
Jesus Christ.
And like, there hasn't been even contact. Like, they haven't held hands or anything.
That is...
Because it's a Japanese, like, reality show.
Oh, okay.
Because, you know, like, Big Brother, they're just fucking on the first night. Sure, and like, yeah, going at it and having orgies.
Sure, yeah.
And stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
It's a really interesting exploration. It's just pretty funny, like, to see certain Japanese tropes, so I guess it makes me racist because I'm laughing at
societal norms. I just decided to talk over it and ignore it.
It's really great. I haven't gotten to the coward incident yet, which is what a lot of people have been waiting, like, telling me about that. Okay. I can't wait. Okay. All I know is the word coward is spelled on an omelet in ketchup.
What?
And I can't wait to get there.
What the fuck?
It's a weird reality show because all it is just four, it's just six good looking young people, young around like 22 or 23, except one's 28. Oh. So obviously he's like the parent or something. He makes people cry, unlike the second episode, because he simply asks, he's the guy that says your dream is unclear, by the way.
Oh, okay. Okay.
He simply asks, what do you want to do in life? And like, some people aren't sure and they start breaking down. Mm-hmm. And like, there's nothing keeping them there other than they volunteered for this.
Oh, so they could leave.
They can leave. They do their normal jobs.
Oh, okay.
They just live in this house together. And
okay.
Yeah.
All right.
It's great. I'm like, I'm into it.
Okay.
I can't wait for the coward incident.
Good God.
I also hear someone in the show later on wears like a really racist mask. Like tribal African mask.
That sounds totally plausible in Japanese entertainment.
So I'm like, looking for, oh, your dream is unclear, Ian.
Your dream is unclear. What episode should I look for with it? Will I know?
Dude, it happens way sooner than you think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because someone had told me about that too, and all I heard was your dream is unclear. When I got to it, I freaked out. So.
Okay.
I'm into it. I'm learning a lot
about. I'm learning a lot
how Japanese culture works.
That's maybe one of my favorite phrases. You know, how is it going? You know, I'm learning a lot.
Maybe not for the better. I'm learning, though.
But I'm picking up some stuff.
Oh, it's great. But yeah. So I guess we'll end it there for today.
Okay.
I can't stand it yet. Your dream is so unclear.
I'm so sorry. Wait till next week when I
will you clear out your dream
that, when I have
will content. Will you make your dream more evident to me?
I will.
Will you work towards your dream?
I will make it more manifest.
Will you become a baseball pitcher like you promised you would be?
I
Watch Terry's house. Thank you. Hey, thanks for listening. Remember, if you have an original short story and want to submit it, send it to storytellercasts@gmail.com. Again, that is storytellercasts@gmail.com. Cast with an S at the end. Good night, everybody.